All right, welcome to the Town of Deerfield Select Board meeting for May 18th, 2016 at 6:30 PM at the South County Senior Center. Thank you all for coming over here tonight. We have lots of activities this weekend, including the book sale, and that's why we're over here. So please make sure everybody attends the book sale and supports the library. I think what we're going to do is start out with you all and your presentation so that it's a beautiful night, so you don't have to stick around and go through all our business.
I love you.
You know what would be really, what would be really wonderful is if you all introduced yourself, because I don't know.
Dan is his name.
Dan. I don't know if you can get the, everyone from the library, the committee. Okay, all right. Okay, Ralph, why don't you start?
Ralph Healy. I'm on the Library Planning Committee.
Kathy O'Rourke, Board of Trustees of the Library. Ben Schmidt, Library Trustee.
David Lamb, Library Trustee, and also on the Planning Committee.
Nancy Maynard, and I'm Chair of the Board of Trustees.
I'm Anne Mary Cluvier, and I'm a Library Trustee.
Candace Bradbury Carlin, and I'm also on the same Library Planning Committee as well.
Daniel Pilato, Project Manager for the Library Grant Application.
Sharon Pitcher, Trustee of the Library.
Sarah Woodbury, Library Director.
Cindy Von Flader, Library Trustee.
And Grant Bial, Library Trustee.
Wonderful. Thank you all for coming. So why don't you go ahead with your presentation? We're really happy to hear, have you here tonight.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Easier for us to
stand. Oh, it's fine. Is that whatever you want to do.
I'm sure it is. It's Thank you, Madam Chairman, for having us. Since we have two new members, I thought it might be appropriate if we just quickly went through what we did before when we met with the Board of Selectmen, and that is to talk about the Massachusetts Board of Library Commissioners grant program. The grant program is a unique opportunity for your town to get a pretty significant chunk of change from the Commonwealth. Unfortunately, the grant program only happens every 8 to 10 years. We're in that cycle right now, and we have a timeline that we have to meet, and you have met the timeline to date. The town of Deerfield is working diligently. The plans are 99.9% complete for the application. In September, the library director of the OPM will be attending a mandatory seminar to go over how the grant needs to be written, and then the trustees will submit the grant application by January 17th, 2017. Independent reviewers will review all of the applications from the state. They're anticipating somewhere between 34 and 36 libraries will apply for the grants. And if you comply with the grant process, you'll get a grant. The unknown is when you get the grant. So, like I said, it was 8 to 10 years. They just funded the last library 6 months ago. They just funded the last library in the previous grant program, which was 2008. So, needless to say, based on need, that library had the least amount of need in the group that went in 2008. That being said...
Is it a bond program?
Meaning?
Is it a bond program that the state funds every 8 to 10 years, or is it...
It's a program that they commit to in the beginning, and then the state funds it in increments.
Okay.
So,
okay.
When you get your grant, I'll go into how the grant works in a minute.
All right.
You're throwing me off my game here.
Sorry. I just didn't know if it was a bond thing that we, you know, how, because sometimes that's...
Sometimes political. They promise it and it doesn't come.
Yeah, but also it's political, so, you know, if we write letters or whatever.
I don't think it would hurt to write letters. They say it's not political, it's based on need, but sometimes that's not the case, but it appears on this... that, you know, we check off all the boxes, they come out, they look at the library, they review the application, and you get put on the list. So the library ad hoc planning committee was created by the trustees, I don't know, it was the Board of Selectmen too, or just the trustees?
The Board of Selectmen was involved.
Yeah, the Board of Selectmen were involved, and for the past 6 months, we've been working with the designer, and we've come up with the plan based on the needs of what the library needs for 20 years the day the library opens. So the library's going to open and have the ability to grow for 20 years. That's the, one of the requirements of the MDLC. The town will receive notice June 13th, 2017 of the grant list. So that's when we'll find out where we are on the grant list. They're expecting to fund 8 to 10 libraries in the first grant round. And that first grant round begins on July 13, 2007, but the entire list will be published on July 13, 2007, and our location on the list will be known.
17.
What did I say, 16?
17. And you said 2003, but I'm sorry. I'm a little nervous being on TV. So what will happen is we need to take 3 votes as a community. The first 2 votes are non-binding. I submitted language to the interim town administrator last couple of days ago on what the articles are. I have a formal copy here, and the library trustees will talk about that when I'm finished. But the 3 articles are to accept the grant is Article 1, allowing you to apply for the grant and accept and spend the grant is Article number 1. Article number 2 is to accept the design as presented. Article number 3 comes after the grant is awarded, and that's the appropriation. And how the appropriation is appropriated by the town is something we'll go over when we know when our turn is. You have 6 months from the date that your town comes on the list. So if we're in one of the lucky 8, we'll have 6 months from July 13th to appropriate our portion of the grant. The designer and the OPM believe we're going to get somewhere between 50 and 52% reimbursed by the Commonwealth. So this is not a small grant. This is a pretty big grant. So that's it in a nutshell. Some specifics about the actual library itself. The plan doesn't come out of the sky. The plan actually comes from a couple of things. The trustees are required to do a 5-year long-range plan every 5 years. And prior to applying for the planning portion of this is the planning grant that we're in, prior to that, they have to submit what's called a building plan. And that building plan's pretty in-depth, it's pretty thick. Copies of it are available at the library, but it defines circulation, how many books are going to be needed in the future, what the size spaces are needed, and things of that nature, meeting room space, bathroom space, all the particulars of a library. And this was designed based on the library building program that was approved by the Commonwealth of Massachusetts about a year ago, a little more than a year ago. So what you see before you is that plan. The design of the plan is 9,000 plus or minus square feet addition to the existing 3,600 square feet of the original library. The original library will be updated but retain its original moldings and character and so forth. But it'll be brought to today's standards with regard to accessibility, with regard to bathrooms, with regard to heating and ventilation requirements. The new library, the heat and the cooling, will be, the air in the library will be changed out every 6 times an hour. So all of today's codes will be met with the program. We will, after we submit the grant application in January, we're basically sitting on the bench waiting for our turn to come up on the list. So the project will kind of sit a little bit until our turn comes up on the list. When our turn comes up on the list and you make your appropriation, we'll actually do the next few steps, which is design, development, and construction documents, which is putting together the actual blueprints and so on and so forth. Meeting with the planning board, getting parking designs approved, meeting with the conservation to make sure they like how we're dealing with stormwater, things of that nature, even though there's no wetlands on the site. All of those things will be handled post-grant. So at this point, we have what we need to do what's called a schematic design estimate. And we are currently in schematic design estimate right now. We hope to have numbers to the CIC towards the end part of next week on what the schematic design estimate would be if the project started in 2018 or 2019.
Okay.
That's
if we're lower on the list, how do the does this how outdated does this become?
The design won't become outdated.
Okay, so there's not a shelf life.
No, there's not a shelf life on the design. Actually, you can change the design. You can actually change everything but the square footage. So if, I'll give you an example. The meeting room's right here. If say we're on the bench for 3 years and they change their mind and they want the meeting room over here and the stacks over here, you can do that. What you can't do is change the amount of space that you applied for. Mm-hmm. So your space can go up or down 5%. So if something doesn't work or you have to squish here or squish there, you have that wiggle room. And it works pretty well. This program's been in effect since 1986. And the MBLC is a little bit different than most other state agencies. They want to give you money and they want you to do your libraries. They push to get these projects done and they're very flexible. It's not like the MSBA. So, and I know you just went around with the MSBA because I remember talking to the previous chairman about it. So, this is a little bit different. The way the grant works is the town will be paid 20% of the grant in 5 individual payments. The first payment comes the day you appropriate your money. So, as soon as you appropriate your money, you're going to get your first grant payment of 20%, which is to help you get through the design and get your permits and all that stuff. Your second payment comes when you have the design done and ready for bidding. Your third payment comes when you have a building permit in hand. And your fourth payment comes when you have a certificate of occupancy. And your fifth payment comes when you, 1 year post-occupancy.
Well, that's pretty fast.
Okay, so, but each one of those payments will be in a different fiscal year. And it will take a year for us to draw this. I mean, if we got the go-ahead July 13th, 2017, it'll take us a year to draw it, bid it. You know, it's time to write. It'll work out, you know, overall. There'll be some short-term borrowing, I'm sure, at some point in time to fill some gaps. But all of that kind of stuff we'll go over when it's time to do the appropriation with the town accountant, the treasurer, and the Board of Selectmen, so everybody understands how this is going to impact the town.
Okay.
We're here to help, and we're sincere when we tell you we're here to help. Like, the picture of this and the design of this is such that the original building is to remain as it is. It's going to get cleaned up. The windows that are covered now by the addition with the elevator are going to go back in, and the addition is going to go behind it, and if you notice, it's stepped behind it. Mm-hmm. And that's to give the illusion that the building out front is still going to remain figural, mm-hmm. and that the addition will not dwarf the original building, the Tilton Library, that everyone just loves to death. So the architect really did a nice job here in creating something that complements it without burying that beautiful facade. I don't know what else to tell you other than I can get into specifics if the board wants me to. I can walk you through the building if you want me to.
Just a question, are you updating all the windows in the building to get them their own painting?
Probably, but we're not that far along yet. That's something that would occur in design development. Sometimes it's encouraged, sometimes it's not. Depends on a bunch of factors. But right. Traditionally, we have to bring this building up to today's energy code,
right.
But the historical section gets a waiver on the energy code because it's impossible to meet the energy code on a wall that's 2 foot thick.
Right.
It's gonna retain all that energy and it's gonna let that energy out. So there's a couple of things that we'll go through as we go through design development to get us as close as possible on the historical addition.
Okay.
Okay.
Do you have an idea of the budget for that building?
We don't, we have to do an independent estimate, independent of the OPM and the architect, and that is in process. We expect to get it in the next day or two. Then the OPM and the designer have to meet with the estimator, scrub the number, make sure the assumptions are correct or are not correct, so that the number that we go in with on the grant is an accurate number that reflects the project as it would be in 2018.
And did they give you an idea of why it would take a year to draw that?
It'll take a year. We have to go back and do additional borings. We'll have to go back and do additional surveys. We have to go back and the mechanical electrical systems have to be designed and installed. Structural systems have to be designed and installed. There'll be more testing done on the inside of the building. To get everything exact, because it's a public bid under Chapter 149, and if you don't have it completely covered under 149, it's a change order. So we take the time to do the drawings correct so that the town's protected on the bidding side.
You did say it was about 5,000 square feet?
I'm sorry?
9,000.
The addition is 9,000?
The addition is 9,000.
Yeah. It's added 9 to the mortar.
So, plus or minus.
Sure. We're going to have our warrant, we're going to open the warrant tonight. And I think we have Article 6 and 7 that is the correct ones that they submitted.
That's word for word copied from Dan's email.
Okay, yes. All right. So, and we're planning on having this June 6th. And so if we're having a special town meeting, we need a minimum of 35 people. So everybody has to bring
We have about 12 in the room right now.
You all have to
No, we need 18 to get it passed.
So you need to bring a friend. So that we have a quorum, so we have, because we have to address our capital requests, which we have the carpet replacement, the air conditioner for the library on there as well. So,
If I may, will the scope of this project be pretty much restricted to the creation of the addition and the outfitting of it, or will there be any additional work done on the existing library building?
Existing library building will be brought up to code.
Brought up to code, okay.
With the exception of the energy code.
Sure.
Electrical systems will be upgraded. Structure will be analyzed and upgraded. Facades will be looked at.
Okay.
We're redoing the basement completely. There's a lot of work being done to the existing building. This is not a paint and paper job. This is a serious renovation, so that the library doesn't need to be touched for 50 years.
It's
the goal.
Sure.
One of the parameters of the grant program is once you do a grant with the MDLC, you're not even allowed to apply for 20. So this is something that, you know, this is a once in a multi-generational opportunity for the town of Deerfield, and that's why we're here.
Okay.
Just to point on that, on the efficiency though, we had discussions about that, and of course we want to retain all the original interior. And the discussion came up about insulation, but they said, really, with a building like this, it's extremely good anyway. That stone and whatever it is, it's quite good. So I don't think we'll have a huge problem. I don't recall on the windows that might be that they'll be upgraded, but.
Right.
Can I be really picky?
You can be as picky as you'd like, but you only get one more question.
Okay, this is it.
Just kidding.
Both floors, I think you've got to do a mirror image consideration. Thinking about sunlight, thinking about what is south and west. I don't know, was that taken into consideration at all?
Absolutely was taken into consideration
okay.
by the designer. Not only was it taken into consideration, this wall and this wall is glass, so that the original building and the addition are not brick to brick.
Sure.
Okay, and there'll be natural light coming through this way.
It's on the back if you want to.
Yeah, turn that around, I think so.
To the middle.
Okay, help room. Me out then, because.
North.
What am I? I got it. Okay.
That's the entrance.
Okay.
Yeah, no, I still don't got it.
North would be this way.
They've removed the elevator.
The elevator is currently right here, covering these two windows.
Yeah.
Okay.
So that's coming down.
Sure.
The new elevator is going in right here. All right, so you can't really see it.
Yeah, you're creating a new main entrance. Main entrance is going to be in the south.
The main entrance is going to be on the same side that it is now.
Yeah, okay. Where the entrance is, where the elevator is, all of that makes sense. That middle section where it connects to the existing library building makes sense. I guess just the larger part of the back addition, purely in terms of just my knee-jerk instinct, the areas where people sit and read and study and examine seems to be on the north side of that building, whereas the stacks and the presentation hall, which may include multimedia presentations such as projectors and that sort of things, is on the south side of the building, where, at least for the presentation hall, you don't want direct sunlight coming through those windows. You'll be pulling those shades more often than not, right?
So yeah. Said, that can be changed.
Absolutely, yeah, yeah. I just said I'd be totally picky, so I apologize.
No. That can be considered. And that when we go to making the design,
we'll
room over to the north
side. Yeah.
Another picky thing which you didn't bring up yet, but I know you're going to, is solar capability. And if you look at the roofs right now are not particularly friendly to solar.
No, right.
It was one of the things that the committee is committed to making the building available to be able to have solar offset electrical costs. So some of the roof lines are going to change, and all that will come when we're doing the structural and we're analyzing the elevations and things like that.
Sure.
This is what we need and all to get the grant and do the estimate based on the schematic level.
Yep.
And a schematic level estimate is at 50,000 feet. As we go down, we'll go down.
Yeah.
Okay. Right.
Is the north side of that glass wall glass as well?
Yes.
Yes.
Why?
It's go ahead, I was going to.
So the director's office can have a window.
If that was made brick and insulated versus the other side, and you left one window open all the time, it would be less, it would cost less to heat the building than having all that glass on the north side.
We haven't done an energy modeling on this yet, so I can tell you that part of this design is bringing in natural light to the inside of the building.
Yeah.
And the natural, if you look at the plan, you'll see it's open here. Mm-hmm. And there's a stairwell here, and you're coming in here, and you've got options left and right, and this whole area is going to be illuminated with natural light from both sides. So from a purely energy standpoint, I can't give you the therms we're losing by it, but it's certainly something that'll come up, I have no doubt, before we're done.
It will be huge, because I don't know if anybody's seen the new courthouse in Greenfield.
Yeah.
The energy cost for that new courthouse is 210% of what it was before. But they got the glass and it looks good.
This is not, this will not look like.
I understand, but I'm saying, like our elementary school, one of the big things when we built a new elementary school was how much it cost to heat the old elementary schools, both of them. And, well, the new one costs twice as much as both the old ones together.
But
and we have 18 feet of glass on the north, never sees a day of sunshine.
I can tell you this, the biggest energy consumer in a building. The old buildings, the old schools had radiators, and the fresh air came from them opening the window. New buildings were not allowed to do that under the energy code. We have to physically take the air from outside, hit it with heat, and exhaust it. Now, we'll do energy recovery on the therms, but you don't gather it all. So your biggest expense on this building is not going to be heating it. It's going to be heating the fresh air. Unfortunately, that's the law.
It is, and I've studied all.
I'm with you. Open window.
Well, no, I'm not saying open window. I'm saying that the cost to heat that versus doing away with that glass and leaving a window open, it would be cheaper to leave the window open. You know, because the BTU loss through the glass is incredible.
Well,
and you could even go with triple pane glass. And I think Trevor would know this. It would take 100 years, and you wouldn't recoup your initial investment of the glass. So, you know, you talk about solar, whatever you would gain with solar in that building, you're going to lose in the heat cost.
We will be doing a modeling, because before we come for the vote, we're going to need to know what the annual costs are for the building. It's going to be a question at town meeting. So we want to be able to have everything you need to make a responsible decision at town meeting and at the ballot box. And if the numbers are skewed really bad by that glass, I can assure you that glass will be shrunk.
Yeah. Well, I was just bringing it up because it is a point in that, you know, the whole thing about going solar is going green. That building's either going to be heated by gas, which, you know, there's a big push. We don't want a gas pipeline. So we're going to go to oil, and oil is going to be much dirtier than anything. So whatever we could do to reduce the heating costs, not only it's better for the environment, but better for the taxpayers going forward. You know?
Okay. One thing, Kip, unlike the courthouses, we've got parking lots.
Wait till that courthouse opens. Greenfield's in for a world of hurt.
Yeah, you ain't kidding. You ain't kidding.
Oh, awful. It's awful. And then that state took the grant for the garage light.
Oh, no.
So, crazy. So anyway, I'd like to turn it over to the trustees because they did formally vote to ask you to put it on the warrant, and I think they can just explain that. And May, any other questions? Thank you for having me. Congratulations on the two of you for being elected. I did 6 years. I'll never go back.
So on behalf of the Board of Trustees, we have met many times over the past year talking about the progress of the project. We're very, very excited about that project. And so we bring forward to you the two articles so that we can stay in adherence to the timelines and move things along. We anticipate community meetings. We need to work to educate the town of Deerfield at large and library patrons. So we hope that you will endorse the articles for the special town meeting.
And I think Doug has put them on as Article 6 and 7 as you presented them, right?
Yes, and this is just a posted draft.
Okay.
If you want to actually vote to do that, we have to vote to open the warrant first.
No, we'll just say yes.
Yes.
And some that we're going to open the warrant when we get to the warrant. We'll open the warrant and then close it, and your articles are presented to you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay.
Do you need a copy, Doug, or is the email enough?
I've taken it from the email and I put it on the warrant, so
maybe if someone wants to look at it.
Yeah, quickly. Actually, Dan, since you've got your original text, if you
want to just verify proof that everything, because this is the draft that we're going to open and close tonight.
I'm pretty sure it's word for word, but
it's good to check it. That way we don't have to worry about it.
Caroline, what time would that special town meeting be that night?
It's going to be 7 o'clock, is that correct, Doug?
We're hoping for, 7 o'clock. We're hoping for June 6th, tentatively. That's yet to be confirmed later tonight, but I think we've got a tentatively scheduled for June 6th, and it will probably be next door at the town offices.
Yeah, it will be at the town offices. We don't use Frontier for special town meetings.
We can help it.
We don't have very many people.
Looks good.
Great.
Letter from
that. Good. Okay. I'll do that. Well, that's
right. Here we go. Thank you.
Perfect. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
All right.
Thank you.
Nice. Okay. Well, thank you all for coming in.
Thank you.
I really, really appreciate it. And thank you for doing all this work.
Yeah.
Oh, it's really great. Exciting. And we have a long way to go, but we appreciate it.
Yes.
We appreciate all the work you've done.
We'll see you on June 6th.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you.
Just remember, we have to have 35 people.
Bring friends.
You have to bring friends. Okay. We'll go back to the beginning of our agenda. Approval of minutes. We have the May 4th minutes. We have both the regular minutes and our executive board minutes. Did you all have a chance to read them?
I read this one.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye, Beth.
Bye.
And we have the May 9th. Do you guys want to take a minute to look at them? May 9th was the short one where we did the FERCOG contract.
An advisory to the board, if you do vote to approve the May 4th executive session minutes, in open session, then the minutes become public available, publicly available. I think at this point, you can decide for yourselves, but I think at this point, that's okay. But that matter has not been discussed publicly up to this point.
Okay, so then we're not going to do the executive session.
Okay. You can go into executive session to vote to approve those minutes.
Do you want to look at the meeting? Oh, here. Here's the mic. You can have my copy. No, it's fine. It was quick. We'll go into executive session at the end of the meeting then and approve the minutes. Doug?
Certainly. Okay.
Yeah. Looks good to me.
Okay. So we're going to vote on, I'll entertain a motion for May 4th and May 9th.
I'll second it.
You gotta give the motion.
Oh, I got to give a motion. I make a motion that we accept the minutes from May 9th and the 4th.
I second.
Okay. Is there any further discussion?
No.
Hearing none. All those in favor?
Aye.
Make that unanimous, please, Doug.
Thank you.
Select board comments. Kippy, you had some comments?
Well, I had a few things I just want to talk about. I checked today and we did pick a color of the shingles, which was quite a stumbling block at the meeting last week.
What color did you pick?
I didn't pick it. I just called the contractor today and said that he got the okay to go ahead and order the shingles.
Yes.
It was going to be a month lead time, and at the meeting, the design project from RDI wouldn't allow the town to choose the color. He said he had to, and he had to have some submittals, and the contractor said he had everything, and he did bring it there, but I'm not sure what went down, but Patty kind of gave him a piece of her mind and criticized him, and it all came and worked out. So he's going forward with ordering the stuff, so the roof's going to get started when it's supposed to.
Is it a dark color, sort of a dark
My
color?
Understanding is that the color was chosen, Marty Barrett and Patty Cavanaugh, and I think Bob Lesko went up with samples up to the building to compare various colors, and they chose a color that will complement the building.
Okay.
Or that will be fairly close to what the current color is.
So. That's fine. I just.
But it was chosen by,
I just didn't want orange or something.
No.
Right, bright purple.
The next thing is, I went to a meeting today with the engineers.
Thank you, Kippy, by the way. Yes. I just want to say thank you very much for making sure that you were there at that meeting.
Which one? Oh, the roof one?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
It was a bit contentious.
Well, one thing that I did point out is that the gentleman from RDI went out of his way to speak to the contractor, and not saying that the contractor doesn't do good work, but he might be a little slow in his paperwork. And he went on and on and on. So I took the opportunity to thank him for looking out for the community, but I told him I had reservations about his design, and that I thought that, it was going to lead to the same problem, and that, if we do have the same problem, I'm going to call him, not the contractor, not the supplier. And he said, well, we tried to mitigate the problem the best we could. And I says, no. I says, that's unacceptable. I said, I watched on TV when Mr. Gilmore asked you directly, and, he wanted one contact person, and you said, you would be in charge of that. So I said, I just want you to know if we have an issue, I'm calling you. And that was it.
Thank you very much, because you know what? We have an ice issue. He's responsible. It's his design.
Yeah, right.
So
yep.
Thank you.
That's right. Then I went to a meeting today with the engineers and the person from Weston and Sampson and talked about the sewer plant. And, when I was watching the thing or listening to it, right off the bat, all I could see was the highway garage all over again. There's this, to me, it's a huge building. It's 50 by 56 feet. And then whatever apparatus they're going to put in one corner. I said, well, why is this building so large over here? And he says to me, well, that's a garage for a future piece of equipment. And I go, what kind of equipment? And he says, well, Kevin was looking about one of these sewer auger things that they currently lease from other communities to clean our sewers, catch basins. And I asked Kevin, I said, well, most of our catch basins are dry wells. They don't really go to the sewer.
And he explained, which I knew, that, you know, there are certain pollutants that run off the road and get in there, and they have to dig that out. And I said, so they dig out the catch basins, which is in the dirt, and what do they do with it? Well, they take it to the landfill. I said, so we can't have it in the dirt here, but we can have it in the dirt over there or somewhere else. It's crazy. So, you know, I expressed my concern that, you know, why should the town or the ratepayers pay all this money for this huge building, and more than half of it's a garage space for something that we don't even have and haven't discussed. And so then he said, well, you know, that can be scaled back. And then it went into, you know, the type of waterproof roofing he was going to put on and the concrete ceiling. And it was just more of the same elaborate stuff that I just didn't think we needed. So I briefly touched on that auger monster. And, you know, he gave me his lowdown on why the screen is better and stuff like that. But he couldn't really answer my questions. So they're going to go back and they're going to look into it more. And we're going to meet again, and he's going to bring you some more information.
One of the things I thought of is maybe we could ask someone who was a treatment person at another sewer treatment plant to come and give a second opinion.
We can.
I feel like, you know, the auger monster is such a good deal.
Well, I said to you before, it was something that I basically stumbled across, but... I'm going to, this week, reach out to the manufacturer and ask him for a list of applications. You know, I want to know where he has these things, and I want to, you know, contact the people and talk with them. My brother-in-law happens to be a chief operator at the Bondi's Island sewage treatment plant in Springfield, and I talked with him about this type of application versus the bar screen. They use primarily the bar screens. Their system is older, and you know, he expressed that they kind of have a lot of the same problems that we're currently having anyways. So that is their method of de-garbaging the sewer water prior to going into the treatment plant. But, you know, that's kind of where it was left. The other thing is the gentleman who was doing the sewer rate study, it's kind of like funny math, because if you generate $500,000 to run the plant, you know, basically we're not saving any money for future use. But he talked about having the basic rate raised from like $60 to $100 per billing cycle, and changing the rate from whatever it is, increasing it, and using that money for it, whether it be the headworks project or, you know, future improvements, which tends to make sense. But it doesn't matter, you know, how you look at it or how the study is, you know, if you need to save money, that's the bottom line. It's just a matter of how you want to, you know, charge the rate payers. Do you want to do it with a single payment, or do you want to raise, you know, the rate by the gallons they use, or however, you know. But it's just I think it's as simple as that. If you're going to increase it, just decide
are
how much.
Are they supposed to give us the options, though?
Well, and those are basically the options. But to me, it's like, it's pretty simple. You know, if you need to raise the money, I don't see where spending...
Well, except that we were going to charge different rates, like institutional rates.
Well, yeah, and you can still do that, you know.
We need to do that.
And those are things to do, but it seems like, you know, you spend a lot of money for these people to do something that seems to be pretty basic, you know? So,
well,
but anyways,
it's supposed to be certified so that we can now then apply for grants. That seems to be the issue.
Okay.
We have to have it
well
done. It can't be just done ourselves. It has to be done by somebody certified to do these kind of things.
So then we have legitimate
rates.
You can just raise the rates, you know. I don't know if it's the Board of Health or the Board of Selectmen, but you can adjust
the sewer commission.
You can adjust those rates. Maybe going forward, you know, the certification that you're talking about might have an effect on, you know, grant money. But, you know, if you look at the big picture, if you're going to pay a lot of money to get these things done, and then you get 50% of this grant money, which is an overinflated price anyways, where does the community really benefit from all of it, you know?
Well, that's why I was interested in the auger monster.
I told, you know, I expressed my concern, and I told them I was going to do some research. We are going to get together. I told them I was available anytime. Whenever they're available, we're going to get together. Hopefully, it'll be in a couple of weeks. The other thing that was brought to my attention that we should maybe consider making a bylaw that requires people who obtain a bed and breakfast permit to
them also having to get a license through the town and have it given only to individuals and have it expire every year, and they have to renew it with a minimal fee, whether it be $50 or $100. Because recently someone has applied for a bed and breakfast and that's not what it's being used for. But now they have the permit as a bed and breakfast. And
I think we can look into it as a bylaw, but I think, isn't it an annual permit, Doug?
Maybe.
Yeah.
There's health inspection.
There's health inspection.
Excuse me, health inspection is related to it. There's no permit.
There is no permit. But when you go to the zoning board for a B&B,
you get essentially either a special permit to operate a B&B or a variance.
But a special permit expires.
It doesn't expire.
No, and a special permit.
I confirmed this with Lisa Mead. A special permit is applied to the property. It does not apply to the individual or the people who own the property.
Okay, so
it does survive a transition of ownership.
So what we need to do is have the zoning board issue the special permit, but then
their hands are kind of tied. Then they came to the planning board, and like he said, it's right. Yeah. It goes with the land, and to simply change that would be just that we're requiring them in Deerfield to obtain a license as well, and not give it to a corporation, give it to an individual. I mean, even in the state of Massachusetts, you know, you can have a multi-million dollar construction company. Someone in that construction company might have to have a contractor's license, and the corporation cannot obtain that. An individual who works for a corporation has to do it. So I think that would be a very simple thing, and if it expired every year, then that would give the town an opportunity. If something is going on that, you know, the neighborhood doesn't like, we can't just say, or instead of just saying, well, our hands are tied because they've got the right to do this forever and always, we can then say, look, at, you know, you're not using this as intended, and therefore we're not going to renew the license.
Are you sure we don't do a bed and breakfast license already?
I'm fairly certain. I've never done. I've never put together a permit for the Board of Selectmen for a B&B.
Right.
Or the Board of Health.
Yes, and I agree, Kippy, then we should definitely do this. I was assuming...
Well, it's just something to think about.
No, I agree.
Yeah.
In
the same way that we don't issue a permit for the Red Roof Inn. There are fees that they pay, there's inspections that they do,
but
we don't issue a permit
inspection.
For that.
Yeah, we...
Yeah, there are inspections. And at any point, if as the inspector goes through, if there's something going on that is outside of a given special permit granted by the ZBA, then our building inspector, who also is our zoning enforcement officer, can issue a letter saying cease and desist, or, you know, corrective remedies, or what have you.
All right.
What's in the language of the permit? Is there something in the permit that says what they can do?
In a special permit, it does specify, in any given special permit, broadly speaking, mm-hmm. it can specify conditions.
Okay.
It can be fairly generic, saying you have permission to operate a bed and breakfast at such an address, or it can be specific, saying you have permission to operate a bed and breakfast with no more than four tenants, with no more than two bedrooms, for only 6 months of the year. It can be as specific as the Zoning Board of Appeals wants to make it.
Sounds like we need to have some language.
Yeah.
Well. Again, this is at least when we're talking about cases where there is a special permit granted by the ZBA, it's unique to every single instance. It's not a blanket change that you make broadly.
Right.
So, for example, there's a bed and breakfast up in up towards Old Deerfield.
Mm-hmm.
That was probably has a bed and special permit attached to it. It has its own conditions. There's another one that was just approved for over on River Road. It has its own conditions. And I know that there was one that somebody wanted for Grave Street, and it would have had its own special
That doesn't
conditions.
Go through the zoning board anyways, because it's a matter of right with a special permit, and this planning board is a special permitting.
No, ZBA.
Well,
for a B&B? If it's not allowed by right in the zoning, then they have to get a special permit through the zoning board.
It wasn't the RA, because this particular case came before the planning board. That's why I was curious. But.
Are you talking about the most recent one?
Mm-hmm.
Maybe it came through the planning board for commentary.
Hmm. I remember there being there, and we took a vote to approve it, but it was
It was supposed to be a bed and breakfast, and part of the building was going to be renovated or skewed to do meditation, and people come from all over.
That's the one over on River
meditation,
Road.
And yeah. That's not what it turned out to be.
Right, and so. that actually was a matter that came before the ZBA.
And that and because of now what it is, it would be very difficult to stop.
Absolutely.
You know.
Doug, why don't you look into it and get some advice from Lisa on how we can set it up? That's a good suggestion, Kitty.
One thing that kind of came across, and I'm not sure how the board deals with it in the past, and this was for a particular person to be, it was called appointed to the South County EMS. Does the Board of Selectmen usually appoint all the employees? Is that the language that it goes, or?
Mm-hmm.
So every, like if you hire somebody from the highway department, you appoint them as, okay. All right, because reading this form, it said, you know, the appointees may not participate in any vote or conduct town businesses unless the appointee has been sworn in by town clerk. That doesn't really apply to this, does it?
It does.
It does?
If you're talking about the EMT or the EMS,
yeah.
Yes, they have to be sworn in by the town clerk.
Okay.
Police officers are also appointed. They have to be sworn in as are other employees in the town.
Okay. To me, it looked like this might be more of a form that you would if you appoint somebody to like the finance committee or something like that. But they use the same form for all.
Yes.
Okay. I think talked about the library thing. The other thing that I happened to stumble on something too. This was from the Board of Selectmen and just appeared on the website yesterday. And this was for an addendum to the ambulance housing thing. Where did that come from?
That was issued by the administrator's office in response to questions and concerns received about the RFP. It's essentially a clarification of the original.
So the original one was wrong?
The original one, yes, was wrong. Matter of fact, the first item on that, where it strikes out three words,
yep.
Those three words were in that RFP because the RFP was crafted from a similar RFP that was published by a town out in eastern Massachusetts. We basically used that as a baseline, modified it, changed it, and instead of recreating everything from whole cloth, we started with that as a basis and then modified it. Those three words should have been removed. That was a typographical oversight on my part.
Okay, and so, but who, I guess I'm saying, did the Board of Selectmen at the time approve that
The RFP.
The RFP was requested to be issued by the by the Board of Oversight of the EMS,
yeah.
And the Board of Selectmen as fiscal agent are
right.
the awarding authority for the RFP.
I understand that, but I guess what I'm trying to get to is the mistake was then made. Was it your mistake?
Yes.
Okay, it was just your mistake, and
yes.
The board didn't pick it up. And
correct.
Okay. All right.
Nobody picked it up, including the Board of Oversight.
Right.
Okay. All right. That's it. We can move on.
Okay. Did you have any other comments? Okay. Board of Health comments. I just want to say that June 29th is the annual meeting for the Mohawk Area Public Health Coalition. It's a new date, and that is one of our meetings, posted meetings. So we're going to have to change.
Mohawk Area
Public Health Coalition.
Coalition.
29th?
Is June 29th.
Yep.
And it's at 5 o'clock at the Greenfield Country Club.
It's just there.
Is that the annual meeting?
Do I need to be here?
No. It's but Kippy, if you can come, it would be good. What it is, we just.
If I can eat, I'll be there.
Yes, it's a free meal.
But okay,
what
free,
it is we're just we go over the whole activities of our boards of health. I'm the representative for South County, and I also co-chair the committee. And if we have an emergency like the H1N1 flu, mm-hmm. it's really good. We just coordinate everything, and we also have emergency funding that we spend and work to do projects and
have to deal with the public health. So what it would do is give you an overview of how we fit into emergency situations if there was a terrible mm-hmm. thing happened, what right. we would do, who we would contact. And there actually is a reorganization of all this emergency stuff. It's called the Health Medical Coordination Group, and that is a new big all Western Mass group. And then it comes down to our Mohawk Area Public Health Coalition. There's the Hampshire Public Health Coalition, Hamden Public Health Coalition, and the Berkshire.
Okay.
And what this big HMCC does is coordinate your extended care, your hospitals, your EMS, and your public health.
Right.
And it's a 24/7 kind of umbrella. And there's three of them in the state, and we're 101 communities. Mm. So if there was an emergency, Mark could probably address it, but. Mm. If there was an emergency and it was public health, there's always a public health aspect to any emergency, and that's why we never fund public. If we funded public health like we should, then it would behoove us to have a separate board of health that would actually have activities to do. But we really don't have any funding. Your board of health, you do
right.
it for free,
mm-hmm.
And we have a little minimal budget. And so there's always a public health aspect to an emergency, and it's wonderful at that point to be the select board, your civil authority, as well as your board of health, because the board of health actually has more power than police in an emergency, and you can make a decision.
More power on health issues.
Health issues.
Well, you can shut down people, you can shut down things.
You can shut down locations, but the powers of arrest and police are...
You can quarantine people, all that
kind
of stuff.
They'll back you up in the process.
Yeah.
Your powers are limited to the help.
So if it was a dangerous situation,
right.
you have the ability to do your civil authority and your Board of Health authority is the same.
Okay.
And so it's very efficient and it's really good for the community. So it seems a little overwhelming somewhat, but I have mm-hmm. to say it always makes sense to do stuff. Like when we had the Irene flood, there was decisions to be made on vegetables, you know, that were flooded. Could
right.
they be sold?
Right.
You know, what the soil, the conditions of the soil after the flood, you know, what contamination there was. There was tanks coming down, propane tanks, all kinds of stuff. And but if we had the avian flu come through and we had dead chickens everywhere, you can quarantine places.
Right.
I mean, it's a good thing. So,
so
what our Mohawk, right, our Mohawk Area Public Health Coalition is just a group of all our boards of health getting together.
And when that's the 29th at 5, you said?
Yes.
And where is it?
At the Greenfield Country Club.
Okay.
It's like a buffet dinner.
Yep.
And we voted to get everyone a free meal so they'll come to the meeting.
It works. We'll let them know. Okay.
Okay.
Will there be a memo on that somewhere, a calendar, an email or something?
Yes.
Just when and where?
Yes.
Okay, good.
Yeah. It's coming out. We'll get
okay.
an invitation. I just authorized it this afternoon, so the
okay.
invitation is coming out.
Great.
But we had to change the date. It was originally tonight,
and
there was too many conflicts.
Yep.
And I registered the select board meeting, and I registered the select board meeting on the 29th. But apparently there was very few other conflicts for the 29th, so
okay.
it got changed to the 29th. Because it's the entire county, so there's never a good date.
Yes.
There's going to be millions of stuff going on.
Yeah.
Okay. So we did the Tilton Library, so mm-hmm. the acceptance of resignations, we have a couple resignations, unfortunately.
Yes.
You have copies of the two resignations. One of
the... Tilton's already done?
Yes.
Yes.
Oh, Mark, is that what you came for?
Yeah.
I
was a little late, I didn't know if they came in, but I went to the library and went to the building because on my notice it said location to be determined.
Yes.
Oops.
Sorry. Good. Oh, sorry. Thank you for coming. We are putting it on the warrant for June 6th.
What?
Well, we have to vote to open and close it, but it's on the warrant. That's what they came in to request.
Right. And did they give you a good footprint on it? You understand what the problem is?
Yeah.
I think, Kibby, you understood what was the timeline.
Yeah. I mean, I heard what he said. I don't agree with the way it is, but that's okay.
Yeah. It's another one, as you said, it's another grant process that goes through, and you've got to be 4 miles out ahead of it, but you don't want it to get ahead of you in, in your ideas, too.
Yep.
So it's important that you stay appraised of all of what they're saying as they're saying it, because it could become a train on its own track very quickly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Sure.
But the people, I know Dan has been extremely forthwith his information.
Yeah.
If you got any questions, don't hesitate.
He's
very good.
Thank you, Mark.
Thanks, what you guys do?
Sharon, did you have anything that you wanted to say?
I just wanted to talk about the center for a minute.
Sure.
Okay. Go ahead, why don't you do that instead of,
Is that okay?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I don't want to mean you to stay.
Yeah, sorry. Yeah. I was just wondering if the flooring was going to be on the special town meeting.
Yeah. It is. It will be. All the capital items, both the items that are to be paid for by the so-called building fund, as well as the items that are to be paid for out of free cash, will be on the warrant for the special town meeting. That includes the flooring for the South County Senior Center.
Is that both rooms?
Kitchen area, lounge area, and bingo hall.
Pardon?
Kitchen area, lounge area, and building bingo hall.
This is bingo.
This is bingo hall.
The request was for all three spaces. The Capital Improvements Committee and the Finance Committee only recommended flooring, I think, in the kitchen.
In the
bingo hall. They did not recommend paying for the flooring in the other two rooms. That being said, town meeting can make up its own mind.
I was just going to say, Sharon, you just have to make sure.
Okay.
Yeah.
We have concerns about that room.
Yeah.
Yep.
And cooking in there and everything.
Absolutely.
And I don't know how many years that.
I was just going to say, I think it's very
long.
It's a sanitary issue.
Yeah, it definitely is. So I was really here for the library, but I was here, I wanted to address that and see where our long range plan is for our seniors.
Actually, we have some exciting news that we it's not public yet. And hopefully we'll be able to release some information at some point.
Yeah.
That's...
But hopefully
things
are going to move forward and seniors are going to get some attention.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's our intention.
I know there's a lot on the plate for the town right now as far as sewer treatment plant. You were talking about the library, senior center. And I don't know what else is coming down the road at us, but I certainly am concerned about the seniors and where they're going to go and what they're going to do. So many are stuck in their homes and no place to go, but they don't have the money to keep these houses up.
Right.
And they're looking for alternatives.
Well, we're hoping that we can address that. I don't want to say in the near future, but in the near future. As soon as possible. It is something that we, I've been trying to get done since 99.
Yes,
and,
okay.
And it's been very frustrating, and we are gonna be working on it.
Great.
And I think we have a commitment to.
You see the space we have in here?
Mm-hmm.
It's pretty hard when you got all the tables in here and you're trying to have activities and stuff.
There's no way to move.
Trevor was in recently, talked to a bunch of people in the other room that were playing cards and stuff. And we had this big hullabaloo going on in here with the bingo.
Right.
So they kind of clash back and forth because you're making noise over there and I can't hear the bingo calling kind of thing. To us guys it's probably no big deal, but to them it's space.
Yeah.
Sharon, I absolutely agree.
Really important.
Just make sure you have people out to vote for the capital items.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah. It's June 6th.
June 6th, 7 o'clock.
Yeah.
Right. At the town hall.
Yeah. Okay.
And we'll hopefully, shortly, we'll have some information that will encourage people.
Okay. sounds good to me.
Good.
And thank you all three for all you do.
Thank you.
All right.
Thank you.
Have a good.
All right.
Okay. Back to our resignations. Actually, I should say resignation for Pat. She's retiring.
Yes.
So, Pat Raymer will be retiring on July 8th. So we'll miss her cheerfulness at the town clerk's office. She's so patient and so cheerful and so nice.
Okay.
And,
okay.
We're really gonna miss
she
her.
She will be missed. Yeah,
absolutely. Yeah.
It's sometimes people aren't very nice, and she's always sweet, and she's
years.
Always smiling. Yeah, I know. That's really.
That's awesome.
Very nice. We're gonna really miss her.
Yep, I'm happy for her.
And we have.
She has the big shoulders at that window.
Yes, she does.
Yeah.
She takes a lot of hits.
Big shoulders and a sturdy back. Absolutely. Absolutely.
She's always so polite and so
yeah.
nice, no matter
so
how
wonderful.
Awful sometimes people are. But she's cheerful to mm-hmm. and helpful to everybody.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. And then the other resignation is for Kevin Helstowski. Unfortunately, he had too much of a good deal in his previous employment, so they wanted him back. So that is a sad loss for us, too.
Yes.
So I would entertain a motion to accept the resignations. Effective July 8th for Pat and June 9th for Kevin.
I make the motion that we accept the resignations as written.
Second.
Is there any further discussion?
Would you also include in that motion authorization to post for these positions? And
I actually was going to make a separate motion.
Oh, very good.
Is there any more discussion?
Mm-hmm.
Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Now I'd entertain a motion to post these positions as soon as possible.
I make a motion that we post for these positions of is it assistant town clerk? What's her title? Or what would the position be?
She's
clerk.
Administrative clerk in
yeah, administrative
okay.
clerk.
And assistant town clerk, yes.
All right, then I make a motion that we post for that position of assistant town clerk and also for the highway employment. That position have a specific title as an equipment operator?
Equipment operator / foreman.
Okay, that sounds good to me. Is that adequate?
Yes. Second.
Is there any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Please make that unanimous.
Yep.
Doug? Okay.
The information on this is nothing that we need to deal with, is it?
No.
Okay.
Well, it is, but we do set aside money
yep.
in our budget every year.
Okay.
And so I did ask Doug about that, and we are able to cover that with
does,
the money that we set aside.
Does Barbara deal with that?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah. All right.
Yes, the money is in the... it's a $10,000 special article that's voted every year to cover.
Now, is that accumulated over time?
Yes.
Or is it just with
the as given the number of years for Pat, she is able to accumulate up to 2 years worth of her vacation time, and she is able to accumulate up to 4 weeks. So 320 hours is equal to 8 weeks or 40 days worth of pay. So she's right at the top.
We have the tax agreement next. And
do I have information about that?
You know what?
I don't think I do.
It. Is it part of the town meeting?
It is on the town warrant, the draft warrant for the special town meeting. The structured tax agreement is, as you know, has been in under negotiation with the Board of Assessors and the developer of the solar project up on River Road. Late last week, they did come to a resolution and then actually worked through a speed bump related to the fire district tax, which up to that point, none of us had even thought about. But some last minute negotiations between the developer and the Board of Assessors was able to resolve that. John Kader has spoken with DLR, has presented the tax structure tax agreement as has been negotiated, and DLR has basically said, yes, it does make sense, we understand it, and it will likely be acceptable to the DLR. That was a linchpin, that was part of what needed to happen. The structure tax agreement, I can tell you, will provide the town with a payment of about $62,000 every single year from this developer. This is a not in lieu of taxes, but this is an agreed amount that will be paid every single year for 25 years, depreciation notwithstanding, so on and so forth. In exchange for this fixed amount and agreeing to the structure, which provides the developer with fiscal stability, the town is guaranteed that the developer will not appeal the valuation of the property. So that even that alone can save a significant amount of money in any given year, as we've seen in the past.
Doug, so since this is a 25-year agreement, it's going to the town meeting to approve.
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly. I was truly hoping to have a final version of the actual agreement to present to you. That's still under final review by the assessors, and it'll have to go to legal counsel for wordsmithing and final review.
So but can we open and close the warrant based on your Article 4 without actually voting to approve the tax agreement?
Yes, you can. Yes, you don't have to take action on the tax agreement, and I wouldn't ask you to because you don't have it in front of you.
All right. Because I was going to say we could put it on the agenda for next week.
Absolutely.
If you have it by
yes.
then. Okay.
Yep. I think that tax agreement is very beneficial to the town because it basically is the same as paying the taxes. But like he said, that they're agreeing not to appeal it. And given the state of Massachusetts' outlook on solar power, there is a chance that in the future that it would be totally exempt from anything, and then we would get nothing.
Right.
So by them agreeing to this, I think
agree.
It's good.
Yeah. I agree. I'm fine with it too.
Yep.
Because we
when we were buying the
we were actually it was more than we had talked about.
And then you're purchasing the
electric. It's going to be
second.
Right. Yeah, that's
you're purchasing at a discount.
I was really under the impression that all the solar was tax exempt, but it fell under a personal property type issue, so that's why
I was hoping we could get a pilot payment, but I wasn't anticipating that much money.
So, yeah. So it doesn't, whatever you want to call it, it's fine. It's still, it's good for us.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay, next item on the agenda is your town administrator's report.
Sure, thank you. There's a number of things I would like to go over. This first one, it may be something that may cause a little bit of issue, I'm not sure. As you are aware, Weston and Sampson has been working with the town since November, with the Board of Selectmen's approval, on creating preliminary draft designs. You may not have a copy of it. Preliminary draft designs related to the wastewater treatment plant. Those designs have been primarily for the headworks operation, which include, as we've already discussed, the bar screen, the grit removal system, and the supporting systems that are involved with putting that material together. One of the things that has come up in the design process over the course of the past several months is the fact that if we're going to do any upgrades to the plant, we need to upgrade the generator that's in place. The emergency power generator right now is a Korean War era device, which does not have the capability to run the plant in the case of an extended outage. It has the capability of running parts of the plant, but not all of it. It just doesn't have the capacity.
Is this mandated by DEP?
Absolutely. Okay. If we're going to do any upgrades, this has got to be on the list.
Okay.
The upgrade, facilitation of a proper generator for the system is going to involve upgrade of the electrical systems there to be able to tie it in, as well as to actually purchase a generator. Of course, we're not talking about doing any of that. We're not talking about buying it. We're not talking about expending money for that. That has yet to be discussed and approved later on. But what we do need to do is to agree to allow Weston and Sampson to provide us with preliminary designs related to that. Since it's outside of the scope of their original contract, they've put together a draft amendment to that contract to provide for designs related to the standby generator, to allow for the engineering related to that, some engineering fee. And I'm not really sure, I'm going to be very careful in what I'm talking about here. Yep, and it will slightly change the amount of money from $130,000, which town meeting has already approved, to $132,900, an additional $2,900 to get this design in place. This is a copy of the amendment, and I apologize, I should have made multiple copies for you to take a look at, but there it is. This amendment simply...
No, that's okay. I'll explain to you.
Yeah, this amendment simply allows the design company to actually implement generator designs in their overall scope of work. Once again, we're not appropriating money other than the $2,900, which Kevin has said that he will cover out of his budget, or we can easily pull from the E&D at the wastewater, the retained earnings.
Why wasn't this included in the first time? I guess I don't understand.
It was simply just not included in the original scope of work back in November or so when Weston & Sampson was first brought on board. It was something that was...
I thought we were talking about this because this was a huge issue.
We may have been talking about it, but it just never got put into the scope of work. Okay. The original scope of work was just for the headworks.
What my two cents that I'd like to add to this is that I would not be in favor of giving them the extra money or the leeway to do this. The standalone generator is something that doesn't need to be engineered. We can purchase a generator on our own. There's many outlets to get them.
How do you plug it in? It's more than just buying a generator, which you're right, you can buy off the shelf.
Currently now they have a generator that they wheel outside if they need and they plug it in. A generator that we could use over there would be a freestanding unit, kind of like what we have at the highway department. It wouldn't even need to be that big. And yes, there is cost to wire it, but it's not a big deal. The cost of wiring it would be just a little bit more than what they want for the study to do it. And here again, it goes back to, we need the generator, we know it, we don't need anybody to tell us that we need one, and no reason to incorporate it. It can stay outside. It's just a matter of running, you know, a few 3-inch conduit lines and making the connections, and that's it. The people that, you know, you can purchase the generators from, it will start automatically. You know, if the power short, there's all kinds of electrical circuits. So. Mm-hmm.
Is the current generator? It says that they're going to put it on a concrete plant pad. Right. Is it on one now?
No, no. It's on wheels.
On wheels.
It's a trailer. It's like a trailer. It's a dinosaur. There's no doubt about it, but it's...
This one will be on a concrete pad.
Just like
it will be enclosed
garage.
In the building. It will be tied into the electrical system. It'll automatically power on.
And it will be provided it'll automatically with a switch over from base fuel tank.
Right. It'll automatically switch over from the grid to the generator.
It'll be inside.
I thought that this thing, part of the designs will include a building, I thought.
No, it doesn't need a building.
But whether it does or doesn't, I don't know.
Yeah.
The simple point is we're not even talking about buying anything or wiring anything in, we're talking about the design for it. Remember that Weston & Sampson was hired to provide with shovel-ready designs so that we can apply for the Mass Works grant to hopefully pay for all of this.
$30,000,
yeah. For what?
This is the addition of the new standby generator increases lump sum engineering fees by $30,000.
Correct. However, because of the way that they are changing the overall scope of work, they've removed the permitting costs from that $130,000 because there's no point in getting permits to build anything when you don't have the money to build it. So they've pulled from that scope of work, or from the 130,000 amount, the permitting costs, which were estimated about 24 or 26,000, and instead put in the generator design costs of 25, 30,000. That's how we keep right around 130, 132 and change.
You can buy it, you can buy the generator for less than that money, Carolyn.
I know. That's what.
So that's, it's not about buying the generator. This won't buy a generator. This will provide us with shovel-ready designs.
You're going to pay somebody to tell you to put a concrete pad there.
It's not about that.
It's exactly what it is.
It's about creating the designs for the upgrade for the plant. If you don't want to move forward with the designs, vote that and we can stop now.
That's, no, you're trying to tie the two together, Doug, and they're separate. The design for fixing the headworks is one issue. Now, just the generator is part of that, but it doesn't have to be included because it's something that, say, that the generator will be placed over here. The connections, the wiring connections are not a big deal. You know, they're really not. Now, the design that we saw today, they had electrical stuff all over the place, and I'm still kind of scrambling and what it all was that they were doing. I mean, he made a big deal about this one only being a 1 horsepower and this one being a 7 horsepower, and yet I see electrical panels that went for 20 feet. And I'm like, what is that for, you know? So I'm trying to wrap my head around where they're coming up with this, and I'm trying to be as nice as I can, but remember, these folks get paid on the percentage of the cost of the thing.
They really don't. They get paid based on
what they're looking at. How about we just put this off until next week?
And what will change between now and then?
Well, Kippy might get some more information on this. And Kevin can talk with Kip on this, okay? Because I have to say, I'm a little shocked by the price, $30,000.
It's not $30,000, it's $2,400. It's a change between the 130 that so town meeting is already appropriated and 132.
So it's a 2,000. But why does, I guess, maybe I need to read this and clarify this. No.
So it seems like we've had, because I'm catching up to speed on a lot of this stuff, it seems like we have a study, and Sampson, Weston and Sampson is putting together a study for us to do the headworks.
They're putting together shovel-ready designs.
So that when we want to go out to bid, we have this.
It's not about going out to bid, it's about applying for a MassWorks grant. The deadline for the MassWorks grant is the end of July. Our target, the deadline for the design completion is the 1st of July.
And we can't get a grant without...
Absolutely, not a MassWorks grant. They won't even talk to you unless you have shovel ready.
Do you feel like MassWorks would approve this grant, or we have no idea?
MassWorks has in the past approved grants for this kind of work at wastewater treatment plants throughout the Commonwealth. What our standing is at this point, I don't know. But Weston and Sampson is confident that these designs would fall squarely in the middle of a MassWorks grant.
We might have two or three cycles that we might have to go through. Before
we can apply, we need shovel-ready plans.
What does the grant entail? Is it like the similar ones, 50% of the money we get?
No, it's 100%.
100% of the money?
It's 100%. If we get the MassWorks grant, we build this. We're done.
That's why on River Road, we waited on River Road kept patching it a little bit because we got $1 million.
Right.
MassWorks, but it took us three cycles.
And again, if we want to put off the work or any work on the wastewater treatment plant until next year, that's great. We don't need to do anything. And we'll have Weston and Sampson send us a bill for what they've done so far, and we'll slow everything down.
Okay, so Doug, what you're saying, this is not $30,000.
No, there's a difference. There's a difference, Cameron. But, you know, what you just said really does change my outlook because I'm looking at this to do the best possible job to improve the wastewater treatment plant.
Sure.
And not have too much of an impact to the rate users. But what you just said is it's not going to make any impact because the state might pay for 100% of it.
Correct.
So it doesn't matter what we do. If we wanted to paint the gold inside, unless somebody picks up on it, we're not going to pay. So I have no problem with anything they want to do if we're not going to pay for it.
Okay.
You know, Doug, do you see the difference?
I do see the difference.
If we're going to pay for it, I want to be really smart about how we go about this. And in my opinion, being smart isn't always paying engineers hundreds of thousands of dollars. But if they're going to get it for free, I don't care what they do.
Well, you have to pay the 130 before you can get the for free, right?
This is increasing this to
132.9. And the town approved 130.
We've already appropriated the 130. That was transferred out of the reserve.
So it's $2,700. It's $2,700 increase,
correct.
Which is okay. Yep. I misread it. I read it as 30,000.
Do you see my point of view, though?
Yes. Oh, absolutely.
Because, you know, I mean, don't get me wrong.
But some of this stuff is like for Mass Works. You have to have shovel.
I get that, but I spent.
Part of being in this state.
Yeah. But I mean, I spent time, and I'm not complaining about it, because I wanted to try and do my homework to do the best that I can for the community. But if it's going to be 100% paid for, why waste my time? You know, let them do what
they
want.
But this is just the headworks. Just the headworks. This is not the whole entire thing, right?
Right, but the headworks is...
We need shovel-ready designs in order to apply for the Mass Works grant, which will... The headworks, it would be the generator, yes, the grid removal and the bar screen, that kind of thing.
And it would be 100% paid for.
If we get a Mass Works
grant. If we get the grant.
If we get it.
And if we don't get the grant, then what? Then we take those plans and all that money and put it on the shelf?
No, absolutely not. No matter what happens, wherever it's funded from, we need these plans. We need the designs to be able to build this.
Well, that's what I'm saying. That's what I disagree with. If we're not going to get all the money to pay for it, I don't like the plans. I don't think that's the most cost-efficient way for the community to go. And I don't want to, you know... And that's, you know what I'm saying?
Well, this will be a conversation we'll have to take offline.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, but we have to pay... We're taking the risk of the engineering.
Okay.
And that...
I get it.
And that could be 2 or 3 years, maybe. But if that doesn't pan out, then I think we need to go through alternative stuff.
I felt that, you know, like you said, well, they need this done by July or whatever. You know, and I get that to a certain degree. If we were going to miss 100% reimbursement, I'm all for that. But, you know, I don't want to push... to get this July deadline, and we're not, because I feel that, you know, I couldn't support spending, I don't even know what the dollar amount is, but the millions, when I feel that there's another solution that would work for a fair amount of time for the community, and then not turn our back on it, but also go and adjust the rates wherever, and start saving money, so when it comes time, the ratepayers don't get hit with a big bill, and we can go ahead and, you know, apply $1 million that we've saved. You know?
What we had before was we had wonderful Dan Lawrence, who was a Weston Sampson engineer. And he did the design work, and we submitted to Mass Works. And he didn't get paid until we got the grant.
Yep.
And what has happened here is they can't afford to front us on the engineering anymore. Yep. Now Dan's left.
Yep.
He used to do that. He used to do that for like conservation districts, other towns up and down the Deerfield River that he's done a lot of work for. And he's been our engineer for, it was over 20 years, wasn't it? It was when I was on the planning board.
Yeah.
So anyway. So
can I make a motion to approve the adjustment of the contract?
Yes. Perfect. We can move on. Would you second that or no? I can second it.
Go ahead.
I'll second it. Is there any further discussion?
No.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. I guess I'm just the one that needs to sign it?
Correct.
Okay. Yeah, I have a problem that we have to risk this now. We never used to, but it's also changed business.
I get it all. I don't want to spin my wheels, sort of say, you know. If we can get free money, then...
If we were starting new with this, if we were starting cold and clean with this project, I think the recommendation I would make would be for us to apply for a grant from the USDA, Rural Development, for design services. They do offer grants of up to $50,000 for design services related to wastewater treatment systems and so on and so forth. And by getting that grant...
That's not enough, though.
Yeah. Well, it's not enough considering that we're looking at a $130,000 design service cost, right. But a $50,000 grant would get us on our way. And that plus possibly some retained earnings and we'd be set. But, there we are. What's that?
We're into this.
Right. Yeah. Remember that with the roof project, the DES roof, we put out $210,000. Ahead of time, before we knew that we were getting a grant. With the library, they got a grant to hire an OPM and to hire an architect, and so on and so forth. And I'm sure there's been other examples in Deerfield where that's been the case. I don't know about the highway garage.
Well, so. No, we had to pay for the highway garage.
Okay.
But Weston Sampson used, like I said, used to be wonderful, but it's regular business now. Okay. Next item on the agenda is our warrant. We have to vote to open, then we can add, and then we can close and set the date all in one meeting. And so before we open, maybe we can just go through this. Mm-hmm. If you all have any questions. I did look at this, but I didn't read it as careful as I normally read it, so.
Take a few minutes.
Yeah, maybe we should take a couple minutes just to, the problem is I read awfully fast, so sometimes I miss typos. So I have to slow down and read it. And sometimes I have to read out loud, which is gross. I won't do that. That's how you can check for typos. Doug, did you have, where is the, we have to have the capital plan, the five-year capital plan? Do we have That's to correct. Vote it as a town?
It will have to be voted as a town. It is going to be a handout at the town meeting.
So where are you putting that as an article?
The capital plan? The five-year capital plan doesn't have to be voted. The only thing that is voted is the appropriation for that year's capital.
So we have to just do the presentation of the capital plan.
Correct. Okay. The capital plan will be published in the newspaper in accordance with the bylaw, and there will be a public hearing on June 6th.
At 6:30?
At 6 or 6:30, yes.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. So Article 3 will cover anything that we have to...
Mm-hmm.
This is all we had?
Articles 2 and 3... Yeah, those were the capital items.
Hmm.
I believe so. I went through the annual town meeting and I believe that was it.
Did that, let's see, there was something about, did Tilton Library printer or copier or something, was that? Did that get appropriated or is that in here as well?
That's under the appropriation for capital projects. It should be the last item on that chart that you have there.
You know
what, there it is. Yep, thank you, Doug.
Yep.
Okay.
Is now the time for us to talk about any of these things, or?
Oh yeah, no, sure. Yeah, because we're discussing it. Because what we do is we vote to open it, and then we can add some items if we want, or then we close it and set the date. Oh my gosh. Good catch.
So it wasn't letter for letter.
Yeah.
Where are you looking at?
Just Article 6, library instead of library.
Okay. The summary next to the article, that's my bad.
That's okay.
I mistyped that. Library. Library. Thank you.
Sure.
Good catch, Trevor.
I'm usually not good at some horrible spelling.
Well, that's why I read out loud, too. Okay. So, we can discuss stuff right now.
Yep.
Kippy, before we open it.
Yeah. I was just... couple of things in this, Calvin. Why would the police department need 11 defibrillators?
That's for the whole town.
That's townwide. John actually is very proactive, and what he did is he checked all the defibrillators, and they are out of date, and they don't match the ones on the ambulance. So the useful life is gone. Mm-hmm. Anyway, so he's put in to replace them for the entire town. Plus the cruisers, a couple cruisers.
So where are they?
They're at front
like the highway.
There's one at the town offices. There's one at the senior center. There's one in every cruiser. There's one at Frontier. There's one at Deerfield Elementary.
I don't actually.
And I think there's one at the highway department.
Is there?
It's in the next room, I think.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, okay. But it is, or it's here somewhere, but it is here.
It's, you can see that they're actually out of date. But they, but the other thing is they don't connect to our, what's the current equipment in the ambulance.
I see. So the expectation is that the new units will, the pads that are used can be unplugged from the portable automatic units and plugged directly into the diagnostic gear that's on the ambulance. And further, the new units that they're getting, the batteries will have about a 3-year lifespan. Those will then go into a cycle of replacement, and the battery replacement is going to be much cheaper than the alternate. Yeah. The pads also have a lifespan, I think, of 5 years.
What do we do with the old ones that they have? Do we donate them to some other?
They're out of code. The batteries are no good.
Yeah, but I know, but I think they might go to like a they could go to a third world country.
Mm. A different believer that may work.
Well, no, what happens is
better than nothing, though.
Yeah, but no, what happens is you donate them to a medical group and they refurbish them and put new batteries in them and then they send them out.
Good idea.
And it's like medicine; it really, you know, they're expired, but not really.
Right. Right.
And so they send the medicine out too.
I talked with Kevin briefly about the truck and tractor. And it seems to be the town's policy in the past where they buy vehicles through the state. And, you know, he said it's easier, so I asked him what was involved. And the other way, and basically it's creating, I guess, an RFP to go out to bid and stuff like that. I just can't see that it's that much work. Because I think we could probably save nearly $20,000 on each one of those vehicles. Not doing it the way that we currently do it.
Do you mean not buying off the state contract?
Yeah.
We can do that. We can certainly choose to not buy off the state contract.
And I talked with Kevin about making a generic RFP and then just fill in, you know, whether it's a Ford, Chevy, or whatever, or John Deere, and fill in the specifications and send them to local, you know.
We can certainly do that. We can build an invitation for bid, and we can work that out. Yeah.
So,
if that's something, actually, that's something where the board has the authority to basically direct town departments and say, we want you to, before buying off a state contract, we want you to secure bids from local vendors. Actually, yeah, that's an executive or policy decision that's entirely within your purview.
Kevin tries to do that.
He does, generally speaking, yes. But it's absolutely a great idea, and I would support it, frankly.
I think where the numbers came from, Kippy, is the state contract, but that doesn't mean that he necessarily
uses it. So if we appropriate this amount of money and we don't use it, it just kind of goes back.
It goes back.
Help him a little bit more because 2 years ago, it told me I stood up and I questioned, that was just before Sean left, you know, and he said, well, that's just the way we do it. And I mean, so I went and I checked what I got, went in the trucks that you could buy locally were $23,500 less. You know, and they're talking the exact same things, you know, so.
Absolutely.
Save the money where you can.
I think they did. I mean, Chuck is the one that does. My God, he's really good. He's like, he drives deals. We got so many deals and stuff.
Well, that's good. And I think a lot of times you might hear me say that, you know, well, can't we cut this? Because there are so many little things that the town really can use. But, you know, if we're not frugal about, you know, $5,000, $10,000, $15,000, $20,000 on things that
we're
looking
at. I think this is just from the state.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But it doesn't mean that that's what we spent. And Chuck, I mean, Doug can verify that Chuck is, he gets us equipment
and
tools and stuff.
Remember that when we're talking about anything that's over $35,000, we have to get a bid.
Three bids.
Right.
We have to go out for a proper invitation for bid. Proactively sending that out to dealers wherever we want.
Right,
we can certainly do that, and that'll help to get more interest.
Right.
But if we send that on IFB and we only get one response, we can go with that response if that's mm-hmm. what we want to do. Mm-hmm. What we can't do is specify a make or a model. We have to be creative about the specification. We can't say we want a Ford. We can't say we want a GMC.
You can choose whichever one you want.
When you send out an invitation for bid,
you
must take the lowest bid. If you send out a request for proposals, can you send out that for goods and services? I'm not sure you can. the rules
you
are kind of sticky.
You can create a spec, though.
You can create a spec, and a lot of times it's
create
a little shady.
Spec.
You create a spec that can that is obviously filled by a specific make and model.
That happens.
And as long as you, yes, the tractor must have a 1,603 cubic centimeter engine.
When Chuck
and there's only one make and model that has that engine, you know, for example.
Yeah, well, Chuck decided what lift he wanted, remember? And he wrote that, got the bids on that, and we got a lift that was substantially cheaper.
Sure.
And we actually installed it in the old garage first, and then we transferred it to the new garage.
Yeah.
And it was so much cheaper. It was
better. Yeah.
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 Great.
So, but anything that you can do to help.
Yeah, I
is good.
Well, yeah, the appropriation of money is one thing. The actual going out for bid, that's something that the board just can simply say, no, you will bid locally. Look for bids locally. And we'll run with that. Absolutely.
The state bid list is not always the lowest.
Not by a long shot. Right.
Yeah. So.
Right. It is, in terms of the legality of buying things, it is really nice to be able to just go to the state contract, pick the thing you want and buy it, and know that you're covered for public procurement purposes, but you could pay for it, right? So.
Well, some things are better deals and some aren't.
Yep, they are.
Okay, so I would entertain a motion to open this warrant.
I move to open the warrant for the meeting.
I'll second it.
Okay, if there's no further discussion, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay, make that unanimous, Doug. Is there anything we want to add to it? Have you heard any more issues, anything that we need to put in here? I mean, we can do it. We can open it and close it next week if something comes up.
We really can't if we're going to make the June 6th deadline.
Oh, you're going to? Oh, that's right.
This has to be delivered to Barb by the end of the week so she can get it out. Literally, it's got to be in the paper by Monday.
Do we have anything, since we don't have an option of waiting, is there anything that you can think of that we haven't dealt with?
Nothing that I know of that can't wait.
The capital items are there. The two items from the school are there.
Oh, I know what we were going to do. We had so many people sign up additionally for the open enrollment for school. Did you check out and find out what we were going to do because it was like $90,000 more than we budgeted?
Right. Do you want to reopen the annual budget, the FY17 budget? Remember that if you reopen the budget, anything can be changed.
Oh, never mind. We'll have to deal with it later.
We have
a shortfall because we had elementary school. We had so many additional people sign up for insurance.
Employees.
Employees.
Barbara's estimating that our insurance costs are going to be about $90,000 higher than what we're budgeting.
Who you have currently enrolled in the budget plus
2% plus 2%.
Two or three more. But we had so many extra in this open enrollment. Barbara is kind of flipping out because it's like $90,000 more.
But Barbara also said that we can just wait until our next annual meeting, and we'll put an article on the warrant for the annual meeting to just basically say to transfer from free cash $90,000 or whatever we need to pay for the FY17 insurance expense.
Can you talk about that insurance thing? This kind of came back up. This girl that was hired left a position in another town and came here and was to take a pay cut from where she was leaving, coming here. But where she came from, she had to pay 50% of her insurance, which was through the state, and coming here, she only has to pay 35% of our good insurance, which was more of a net income. So it wasn't, her bottom line is she's making money. But I'm just bringing it to attention, you know, that's.
Well, our Sunderland pays 50%. Waitley pays.
Waitley pays 65. Waitley pays 65. 65, I think. I think Conway pays 65 or 70. Or does Waitley pay more?
No, Waitley pays more than us. I think. I thought we were in the middle.
And you're talking about town employees only.
Right.
town employees and police employees.
Yeah, but they're all teachers.
CBA. Teachers are a whole different animal.
No, they still pay the same.
Really?
We're talking about Frontier. Yeah. Frontier pays.
Frontier is a different animal. Right.
Yes.
But all our elementary
but
school.
But elementary right school is our...
Is 65-35 still?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. And so we talked about changing that years ago when the insurance costs are going up dramatically. And they have been... Zeroing, I mean, we've had relatively zero increases because mm-hmm. the Hampshire Trust is really
doing
real
a good
job.
They do.
The problem is this time we have about a 6% increase. It's solely right. related to drugs. Right. You know, the pharmaceuticals right. have been.
It's going
to
go
you know,
up again next year.
People bought, you know, rich people, hedge funds, been mm-hmm. buying these pharmaceutical companies up, and then they just
yeah,
up the price of drugs and they yeah. pocket the money. Yeah. And if you think about it, we went up tens of thousands of dollars. The FERCOG went up tens of thousands of dollars. So you multiply this across the whole country.
Yeah.
I mean, it's just billions of dollars.
Of money.
People are just pocketing money, and it's awful.
It's
so, Barbara, I talked to Barbara. She sent out the information because, of course, there is copay with drugs. So it's increased costs for our insureds as well. So. She sent out information. I had gone to a meeting and I heard about you could buy the drugs through Canada. So she mm-hmm. sent, she tracked down the information and sent out the information to people. So ultimately, some people can buy some of the drugs through Canada and their health system. Mm-hmm. And so it's cheaper for them and cheaper for us, obviously. So that information she keeps, it's posted, she keeps it out, she hands it out to everybody that signs up and is handing it out. So maybe we can reduce some of our costs, and that's what we're trying to do through the whole Hampshire Trust is to get people to use the Canadian drugs instead of American drugs.
So we're gonna get too sidetracked. Do you want to just close this out for now?
Oh, okay.
We'll
yeah. So that was the only thing I was. Okay. It was in the back of my mind. And
you don't
want
but to open the budget.
No, I don't
okay.
want to open the budget because that's everything. Yep. That's everything.
That's a can of worms.
Anything yeah. could happen.
No. Okay. So I would entertain a motion to close.
I make a motion to close the town board.
And I'll second it.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And we set the date for Monday, June 6, 2016. Do we need a separate vote for that, Doug, or we just say that? Well, let's vote it. Well,
yeah.
Case,
let's,
and do you want to put a time actually, in there, too?
Yeah.
At 7?
7 o'clock. Because I'm not actually sure about that. I forget.
Well, I had it 6 in my phone, and then we talked 7,
well,
so I
well,
changed it.
Well, the reason why is because we're going to have the Capitol meeting.
Oh right, yep, that's at 6. Yeah.
Or 6:30.
That just sparked something. This was a problem at the annual town meeting because the Capital Improvement Committee didn't have a public hearing. Did they have one this time?
It
we're
going to
have
be,
the public
yep.
hearing. We'll have the public hearing before the town meeting.
At 6:00.
6:00.
Okay.
We're meeting next week.
Yep.
And we're going to and it was my fault because I didn't want us to have a public hearing on an outdated plan. So we talked about it in committee, then we talked with the finance committee, talked with the board of selectmen, and everyone was fine meeting, because we had committed to meet, you know, May 25th to come up and start making this. So John has been putting a lot of effort into this, and we should be ready for the 25th okay. for, Doug has been working on the spreadsheet with him. We'll have the spreadsheet ready, right, for the 25th?
Yes. Yeah.
We haven't been able to get elementary school stuff. I've
what
talked to
mean?
Jean
oh.
Hale.
Janine,
yeah. I called her because John had emailed her.
Yeah.
And, you know, she kind of said, well, I'll get back to you sometime in the fall. And so I called her and said that, you know.
Now it's over here.
Yeah.
Okay.
And
we will
like,
be redoing this process in the late fall, early
yes,
winter anyways.
And that's what I told her.
Right.
I said, if you don't have anything, that's fine. But,
right.
you know, there should be some
you
basic
be
stuff, like the heating system. When's
you definitely
the,
should
when's
be
the,
asking. Okay.
When's the life expectancy of the heating system, the refrigerators, anything big.
Yeah. Okay.
So, anyway, I'm going to harass her again tomorrow.
That's the principal?
Yeah. I It doesn't matter because we'll be updating it in September, in October.
Yeah.
But
okay.
I thought we should put it out there.
Have you done the motion to actually schedule the meeting?
No.
Okay. So you're going to make a motion
to set the meeting at 7 o'clock on Monday, June 6th, at the town offices at 8 Conway Street in the Village of South Deerfield.
I'll second the motion.
Is there any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Does the school currently have a fund that they save for replacement of different items in it, whether it be heating, air conditioning?
Well, what we decided from a capital point of view is that in the operation budget, there should be regular wear and tear, small items.
Yeah.
We agreed to do carpeting because carpeting was generally more than a 5 year. If it's more than 5 years, and over a certain dollar amount. And the dollar amount has changed over the years, but most things should be in the operation budget, except if it has a life expectancy beyond 5 years.
And I think they'll have that stuff. So I think they're waiting for that roof to get done because they've had leakage and mold and stuff in those carpets. And I think they're, as soon as they're dry, I think they want to go through and start doing some stuff there.
Not only the school, but do all the departments have any sort of capital savings accounts?
No.
We don't let them do that. And they're actually not allowed to.
Really?
By our law auditors.
We could establish capital stabilization accounts.
That's right. That's one of the things we want to do.
We can label each one for...
Well, what we were going to do is selling the land. We're selling these pieces of random land, and we were going to put that as a seed money for our capital accounts.
But do you think we should look at having the stabilization account for it? Like the police, sewer, the highway, and the schools, and divide it portionally, and then every year fund that?
That was why you had the 5 year plan.
Yeah.
And you were supposed to be
set for it.
Yeah.
But there's been no money.
I was the planning board rep onto the capital improvement, so I've been on for a long time. And we used to put $400,000 or $500,000 away. We haven't been able to do that in the last, 3 or 4 years. It's been really tough. So that's why we decided we've got to do something more serious. And we haven't updated our plan. That was why we blew past the plan, because we said this is not even relevant plan. But we made a commitment to the 25th. We're gonna have the plan ready for the 6th, and hopefully. And then we'll work. Then we'll be in a cycle for the fall.
The other thing I was going to ask about is there any was there any thought put into the town employees that work for South County EMS that if they continue as town employees, and then when they retire, do the other towns contribute to their retirement, or is it just all come out of Deerfield?
They're employees of the town of Deerfield.
Right. So, if
yeah, but their pay we contribute to the retirement system.
You're broadly speaking. Now we haven't had employees in long enough. Maybe with the exception of Zach Smith, David Zamoyski. There's maybe one or two others who are in the retirement system. I think Dave and Zach both have enough time with the town of Deerfield, and they've been contributing to the retirement system that they are eligible for retirement health benefits. Remember that they contribute to the retirement system, and let's say they get 30 years in. Once they retire, we no longer pay them anything. The retirement system pays them.
Right, but...
That being said, what has happened is retirees who are in the retirement system are also eligible for certain health benefits.
Exactly.
That is paid for entirely by the town.
Correct. So that's what I'm saying.
If
Joe or John Smith does this work while he's employed through the South County EMS, the three communities are basically contributing to all of his expenses. But once he leaves that employment, and now he's collecting money from the retirement fund, he decides, well, I want to maintain my health insurance. The town of Deerfield has to pay 50% of that, even though he's retired.
Correct.
And we're not getting any money from these other people.
What should happen is we should look into modifying the enterprise fund for the EMS to include an OPEB accumulation.
But we can't do that until we have an OPEB plan. And we had a big fight last year.
What is the OPEB?
I know. OPEB is other post-employment benefits, i.e., health insurance for retirees.
Yeah.
Exactly what you're talking about.
We have, I estimated based on what Barb had given us as information, that we had a $1.3 million liability. And Mark didn't agree because it was just an estimate, but I didn't want to pay to give somebody to pay to give us the estimate, which was going to be like $10,000 or $15,000.
Yeah,
but to pay us to give an estimate, because we are required every 3 or 4 years to do this under the audit. And our 2017 audit, they will give us the OPEB number.
Right, but
so, we're just waiting to find out what our real liability is, then we'll come up with a plan, and that's when we'll apportion.
Well, I mean, it could be as simple as, you know, we know how many retirees are out there that are on plans now, so we have that cost. And we probably could guesstimate how many employees might retire because of their age and stuff like that. So you could come up with a pretty accurate number of what our liabilities will be and start to fund that. You
know? I will guarantee it's over $1 million, but
a year?
No, total.
Oh, well. I don't know what you mean by total.
See, this is the other thing that I've never been able to figure out myself, is exactly what that $1 million represents.
Really?
Does it represent the medical costs for our retirees in any given year?
Well,
does
that's it represent all we have. That's all we have.
Well, except the medical cost for our current retirees is only about $150,000.
Yeah, but it's split between the school and the two-thirds the elementary school because of the amount of employees they have, and a third town employees.
But I've looked at the raw numbers from Barb, and just if we pay $900,000 in health insurance in every year, about 100 to 150 of that is for retirees.
Yeah, but
and we're doing it on a cash-only basis, so.
I know. Well, yeah,
but we pay about 800, 900,000 a year,
something like that. Okay. Yeah.
It's now with a 90,000 additional, it will be.
And
it's going to be up.
And remember that a retiree is not.
Is that what we pay, or is that the cost of the insurance? Because
no, that's the cost of the insurance.
Okay, so.
But a retiree's insurance is not the same type nor the same cost as an employee's insurance. Mm-hmm. It's a different kind of insurance, and it's a completely different rate. It's a different copay, and down the line.
They pay 50%.
It's a 50-50, but it's also a gap, a Medicare gap insurance.
I don't think so.
Well, Kippy, it doesn't matter. Don't worry about it.
That's a conversation you might have with Barb. She'll be able to fill you in on that.
What we did is the finance committee agreed they didn't want to fund anything. So, and I was fine with that because we don't have a number, we don't have a plan. So the idea is that in 2017, when we have that audit, the auditors will generate the amount of our liability, and then we'll apportion it to the schools, and we'll take our two-thirds to the schools, and we're gonna have to come up with a plan that we fund it out of our budget. Well, and so that is gonna be essentially gonna be a huge cut at some point. Okay. But there's no sense in stirring up. I stirred up everybody.
At the municipal conference, the governor didn't have an answer for the question either.
And everybody's going to
sit up and ask and said, what about OPEB? And the governor said,
I don't really know. Why don't you come and talk to me or something?
Come on out, we'll talk about it.
Right.
Yeah. But currently we're just paying it as part of our insurance.
It's done on a cash flow.
Yes.
And it's just not even worth fighting about. Because I got spun up when I went to the MMA conference I went to the workshop, and I was like shocked because there are some towns that are really organized on this and have a plan and have put away hundreds of thousands of dollars. Nice. And I was like, oh my God.
I think it's Lee that put away about 10 or 10.2 or $10.6 million fully funding their OPEB liability. $10.6 million in a bank account that they will never touch.
And it was unbelievable. And I was like, oh my God, we aren't doing anything. So I flipped out. And I was like...
Well, we basically pay for it every year.
Yeah.
You know, it's part of our budget. We're paying our current commitment as we go.
As we go.
But it's not the future commitment. And that's when I... Barbara came up, you know, we went through the information, and that's where we came up. I came up with $1.3 million. I was totally freaked out about that because I was like, how can we, I mean, we are barely covering, we're using free cash to cover our operating budget. How can we take this? I mean, we're talking about laying off people so we can pay, future people.
And the potential for future people, because like if we had started setting aside OPEB costs for Kevin Helsowski, let's set aside, you know, X dollars for him. He left 6 months later. He won't ever benefit from the retirement system. So we set aside money in an OPEB account for him that he'll never use.
Was it just for him?
Well, no, I'm certainly saying that if we count our employees in any given year and use that as a basis for our retirement liability, that's inaccurate. We have teachers that come, work and leave and go to other jobs 3-4 years later, and they'll never benefit from
the workforce gets older. You know, people are living longer, and so this is, you know, it's not going to be a whole long time before we could see, you know, 3 or 4 principals collecting this, 3 or 4 police chiefs, 3 or 4 sure. highway, you know, and sure. so not only we're paying for this, but we're paying for all that too. Sure. And with the way everything is, it's just going to keep making a bigger and bigger drain on it. And
so your point, Kip, was that you'd like to see some money set aside from the other towns also to, or a proportion of that, which we'll do after that.
Yeah, I mean, something to think about because, you know.
Oh, absolutely.
When time comes, you know, then we're going to be
But stuck. Doug is correct. The only people that have really been on scams long enough are our own employees.
But now is the time to think about it, you know, and I just wanted to plant the seed.
So next year when we get your audit,
When we get what it is, then we'll generate a plan.
And once we do have a sense as to what we need to be setting aside for any given employee, then those set-asides, those costs per employee, can be applied to the South County EMS budget, and then all towns will have to support it. Yep. But that's a very, very valid point.
Yep.
Yes, very valid point. It's just, we agreed not to... Well, I just gave up because you get really, I got spazzy about it. And I was sort of like, I can't believe it. We owe more than $1 million. And we weren't being proactive and it was just hanging out there, but I might as well just hang another year because.
Well, it is, I can see that it is an issue that, we're a very small community, but we have some really big expenses, you know.
Mm-hmm. Well, it bothered me because you need to be sustainable and you need to be proactive. And I felt it was a huge commitment that by ignoring it, we were doing a disservice to future people. But I also was getting so much pushback.
Your friends is it?
What?
Mosquito.
Oh!
Tico.
Actually, yeah. I'm hoping to get a grant. I didn't want to talk about it because the meeting is getting long, but I'm hoping to get a grant to explain. Once we get an assessment, hoping to get a small grant to pay for them to come in and explain all the different kinds of mosquitoes and all that kind of stuff so that people will be informed.
Yes.
Well, different. There's like seven. I mean, we have at least probably 7 or 8 different kinds of mosquitoes, and they have different habitats.
They all buzz in your ear and they all bite you.
Yeah, but they don't. They bite. Some bite during the day. The daytime ones are the ones that carry the most of diseases and all that kind of stuff. So anyway.
We're doing police appointments.
Okay.
Yes, we need to get going. Sorry.
It's all right.
You have a letter of request for an appointment to the South County EMS board. From an individual interested in serving on the board, but in conversation with Carolyn earlier, I know that this is a larger discussion.
Yeah, I think we're just going to wait for a few minutes. Until next week or so.
Can I ask you, is David still on that, or did he resign?
No, David's still on it. All the appointments are until June 30th.
Okay, I don't know if he recused himself because he's not here.
No.
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 Not yet.
No. Okay. Yeah.
I don't believe that. Yeah, I don't think he resigned.
Well, right. We need to discuss it, and okay. I feel like we need to discuss it in the
whole discussion.
But let's do the police officers.
Okay. Yes, you have the list. This is a two-sided list. Police officers are, by state law, appointed indefinitely for an indefinite term. That's to ensure that an appointment cannot be not renewed as an indirect means of firing the police officer, or sort of a backdoor way to fire an individual. Mm-hmm. These are for the that's just state law. And so the police officers that are listed with an indefinite term. Mm-hmm. Those are officers who have been here for 1 year. The one full-time officer was just hired this year, and since he's on a one-year probationary period, he is only appointed for a single year. Next year, he'll be appointed for an indefinite term. Okay. All the others are special officers or other staff, and they are appointed for one-year terms. The chief was good enough to put the current hourly rates for each individual.
Mm-hmm. I would entertain a motion to...
I make a motion to approve the appointment to the Town of Deerfield Police Department.
I'll second it.
Is there any discussion?
No.
Nope.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Make that unanimous, please. And make sure you thank John for being very efficient. We have the one-day liquor licenses.
These are things that just came in, actually just the beginning of this week. Normally we would let them sit and hold for a regular meeting, but because one of the days was for one of the events was May 24, we figured we really wanted to get this done to make sure that DA could get their events up and running. These are done every year. They're part of the alumni events that happens at the end of the school year at Deerfield Academy. We've never had issues. They're always extremely responsible. They are following the rules and regulations of the ABCC when it comes to purchasing their alcohol supplies from a proper vendor and for policing themselves and making sure things are done the way they should. The Deerfield Club of New England, the event on the 24th, happens quarterly, I believe. Broadly speaking, the alumni reunions happen over the course of several days, and I think last year there was some conversation in our office that this really should be separate events and separate permits because they're at different locations and across different days.
It looks like they paid accordingly, though, right?
They did. They paid four separate days.
Right.
For these four separate events.
Okay.
So it's a single permit, but it's valid across the 4 days. What we will be doing is generating a permit for these, one for each location, valid only for the day of the event.
Okay.
And what we need is a motion to approve both of these and to authorize the use of your new signature stamps so we can process the permits.
Make a motion to approve them. One special one-day liquor license for Deerfield Academy.
I'll second it.
And I will just add the dates, May 24th, June 9th, June 10th, June 11th, and 12th. So we have five specific licenses. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Make that unanimous. Thanks for doing that.
June 24th.
Yes, I told you, but I didn't remember if I sent you the thing.
Okay, so I'll sign up for that.
It will just give you a good overview.
Definitely.
It's actually, I have to say, I didn't even know that I was Board of Health for a few weeks after I got elected selectman. Finally, someone said we're having a hearing, and I said, what? I didn't even know anything about it. No one told me, but I have to say I'm very interested in public health, and it's a constantly changing field.
Right.
It's one of those things. It's very interesting.
Yeah,
Carolyn, do you usually keep all of this?
No. You know why? Because
the pile gets too big.
My dining room table gets hidden. I have to clean it off for Christmas and Thanksgiving and the last couple weekends for you know, when I had kids home and stuff, and I try to recycle as much as possible.
Yeah, this is why I did ask about the option of using tablets for these kind of things.
I know, but you know,
every meeting there is packets of information like this, and very little of it will
even. I try to recycle this, and it drives Doug crazy. But the problem is, I'm old-fashioned. I have to highlight it to remember it, and then I do keep things. That I think is important, like these end of the month reports.
Yeah,
I keep
very useful.
I keep 2 months worth, and then so I'll throw out March's because I have April's and now I have May's.
And you have all this information on the computer, anyways.
If it's where it's all stored, right?
Okay.
The next thing's in your packet. Speaking of paperwork, after your notice about the orientation for local public health in Mass. Mm-hmm. You've got an email sent to me from the police chief informing, of course, I believe you received all of this as well, that he and the sergeants will be away next week. And he provided information in terms of contacts, what to do and when. The chief is extremely good about staying on his cell phone and being available through that week, and he's really only a couple of hours away if something very major happens. And he has no problem with coming back into town if desperately needed.
The only thing that I would just like you to check with John is that we have adequate radio coverage this year. And if not, should we order the MEMA communication truck to come up?
Adequate radio coverage for what?
Well, Deerfield Academy graduation.
The towers were down last year. And we had the radio truck come up. And we've had issues with the radio transmission.
I see. Okay. I will check with him. I am certain that given the fact that the U.S. Marshals Service is going to be here coordinating a lot of the event, the U.S. Secret Service, that communication is going to be key with that.
Yeah, but they have their own.
Yep.
They have their own.
I believe we also have one person being delivered by helicopter that weekend. So if anybody up in Old Deerfield hears a helicopter, that's...
I'll be sure not to shoot it down.
Yes, please don't.
Victim zero.
Keep your drone. Anybody has a drone, make sure they put away.
Yeah, put them away.
I included a couple of other things in the packet. The next thing that you should have on your list is a note related to the Western Mass Forest Legacy Partnership. This is something I believe we've received a request for a letter of support in the past. And I'm happy to put this letter together. We recently supported it back in 2003.
This was in our meeting last week, right?
Was it?
2 weeks ago.
Okay, yeah. Very good.
I think we voted it.
Yeah.
Did you?
Yeah.
I'm sorry, I must have missed it. We'll put that letter together and get that out.
Thank you.
Let me just make a quick note of that so I don't miss that.
What did you want to talk about the
I do. This is a note from Joe Markarian, who's the consultant that's working through the COG with us in developing financial policies. What he's presented is essentially a guideline or a draft document that we can use to start to talk about building financial policies. This has been talked about for about the past year and a half in Deerfield. How we do things, what are our policies related to OPEB, related to capital stabilization, related to general stabilization, related to the use of free cash, related to budgeting, and down the line. The town doesn't really have policies which help us to determine our course as we go through the year and develop a fiscal budget or determine how we're going to work through saving for capital expenses. Joe is available as a consultant for the town to help us develop policies that not only make sense, but policies that everybody can agree with and buy into. Mm-hmm. This outline basically gives a broad overview of the types of policies that other towns have adopted. This isn't an a la carte. This isn't finished policies. It's designed to give us sort of a structural overview of what we could look at. And I encourage you to take a look at it. I wouldn't expect you to do anything about it this week. But I do want to bring this back up next week or the week after at the next regular meeting to talk more about this.
How busy is our agenda for next week?
The agenda next week is primarily dealing with Pink & Company, the presentation of the Clerk of the Works, an update on the Deerfield Elementary School project, and probably items related to the South County EMS. Pink and Company is not able to arrive until 7 o'clock, and I was going to recommend that we've scheduled the meeting to start at 7, knowing that the CIPC meets at 5:30, I think, that day.
Okay.
So that'll give the CIPC a little extra time.
What's the timeline on this, Doug?
There is no timeline.
Yeah, but I thought we committed to doing this by...
Within the year?
Okay.
This is one of the three items that we identified in our community compact mm-hmm. agreement that we were going to focus on, financial policies. And I do want to push this through.
Right. No,
if we can, but...
What do we have on our June 1st agenda? Is that going to be full?
I don't have anything on it just yet. Okay. I haven't built anything yet.
All right. Why don't we put this on the agenda for the 25th? So what we can do is... if you guys wouldn't mind looking at this, and why don't we prioritize some of the things that we think are really important. I mean, we were talking about a capital improvement, mm-hmm. and then, and putting together a capital stabilization fund.
Right.
So why don't we just look through this and see if there's anything else that really hits you. Some of the stuff we already have. Like the OPEB, if you look at it, we've right. already established the liability trust fund. We just haven't funded it. Yeah. So look through this, see what you guys would see as a priority, and then let's put it on the June 1st agenda, okay? Mm-hmm. To make a decision.
Okay.
To schedule them in.
Okay. Now I'm assuming.
So we're going to have a preliminary discussion on the 25th. Sure. And then we'll have further discussion on June 1st.
You're not expecting that we're going to have solid policies on June 1st, right?
No.
Right.
This okay. is a game plan. We're going to decide what we're going to do. We're going to do a right. preliminary so we can decide what our priorities are.
Right.
So we can have more thought into this
right.
next week. And then on the June 1st, what we're going to do is set up a time line of actual implementation, and we have to sign... I mean, I'm sure we're going to have to reserve this guy to come in and talk to us, right?
True, but the expectation is that the town is going to do a great deal of the work independently.
Okay, you to think about between May 25th and June 1st, how you would like to have, how do you want to accommodate the workload?
Okay? Sure.
And have a timeline in your
sure.
head based on our preliminary discussion on the 25th, okay? Does that make sense to you guys? Mm-hmm. You see what I'm trying to say? Is to like
yep.
have that's some fine. Thought. Because I don't like to make a decision on this like tonight because I haven't really thought about it.
Right, absolutely not.
Okay.
So, okay. I included an email from Jonathan Edwards about a potential Senior Center Board of Oversight meeting for Monday the 23rd. However, Monday the 23rd is also the day that we've scheduled a South County EMS 3-town select board meeting. Mm-hmm. At 6 p.m., so I'm guessing that the Senior Center Board of Oversight meeting will be preempted or will be rescheduled. To that end, I do want to bring that up. You've got an email from Matt Russo. I'm not sure why that's in there, but it's entertaining reading. It gives you some sense of an ongoing conversation that was going on via email in relation to the South County EMS, the FY15 indirect costs, how those were paid, and then a number of other really kind of hairy offshoots from that conversation, which probably don't have any place here. You have this kind of bare bones list of appointments. These are the appointments that the select board make every year. Kat Dolan has been working like a dog, trying to track down who has been appointed to what board or what committee, when, and when those terms expire. She has the elected positions down pat from 1970 all the way to the present. Fantastic. The boards and committees are harder to track. Even if a person was appointed to a committee, we're trying to correlate with that with when they actually were sworn in to serve on that committee, when they were appointed by the board, and for what term. In many cases, these are multi-year terms, and so tracking the seat, if you will, that may be filled from one year to the next has been a bit of a trick. We hope that within the next week or two, we will have a sense of whose appointments are up in June, whose appointments shall continue, and we'll provide you with that list. With your permission, we'll also proactively seek out those people whose terms are up and ask if they want to be reappointed.
Okay. South County EMS on this list?
South County EMS, the Board of Oversight, should be on this list. I'm quickly checking. Huh, it is not here.
Okay.
That's a big...
Just add it in.
Yeah. Please do. These are not meant to be a listing of appointments that you're going to have to make. We've still got to determine who is on these committees and what chairs are empty, or whether or not a person's term is expiring.
The other one is the Board of Oversight for the Senior Center.
That is on there.
Is it? Oh, South County Senior Center. Yeah. Okay.
So that's more informational than anything.
Okay.
So when do the appointments, we have to do it prior to the end of June?
Correct.
Yeah, June 30th.
Yeah.
We have actually three meetings in June, so it's not too, the only ones you really want to be concerned about are the police officers and the EMTs, and you know, the ones that we have medical liability for, you know, we have liability for all our employees, but the ones that are most likely to have caused this problem, we want to make sure there's never a gap.
What's this?
What did you want us to do this about the amendment, Doug?
The IMA?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. This is for your information. I strongly urge you to take a look at this, become familiar with it, because this will likely be part of the conversation happening on Monday night. This is actually going to be a good deal of it. Our hope is, the IMA will likely not be the entire scope of the conversation, but there will be some discussion about it. Now, the Deerfield Select Board has already voted to approve these changes to the IMA. However, I think it's worth having the conversation with the other two select boards to make sure everybody understands what these changes mean. Mm-hmm. And what impact they have. I want to point out on this IMA, if I may, page 7, Article 5, Section 2, Amendments, the highlighted portion. And it reads, substantial changes to the agreement, such as a change in location or the addition of a member town, shall require town meeting approval in each then existing member town. The addition of a new member town, let's say Conway wanted to be a part of this, that seems pretty obvious. A change in location has never been defined by this agreement. The location, the term, has not been identified. Where the South County EMS operates has not been identified by this agreement, and has never been established except by practice. That up to this point, the ambulances have been stored, one in each town at the various and sundry places where they're stored.
So this is just a proposal.
What do you mean?
Well, it says, a substantial change to the agreement, such as the change in location. So there's nothing. Are they proposing that they're going to change that?
Nobody is proposing either a change in location right now, nor a change to that language right now.
Okay.
There is some question as to whether or not... See, broadly speaking, because this is an intermunicipal agreement, the three select boards could, of their own accord, vote to change this agreement. It's permissible without approval by town meeting.
Okay.
The select board can simply say, we vote to change this. And if that same thing happens in the other two towns, then the agreement is changed.
So, from my understanding of all this, so Deerfield, all the three towns have an equal vote.
We have three votes.
Okay.
Deerfield has voted to give its third appointment to the Board of Oversight a vote. The other two towns have not yet approved that. Until they do, Deerfield has two votes.
You call in.
They all have two votes.
Each town has
that,
two votes.
That's not what I'm getting at. That's, what you're talking about are the members of the Board of Oversight. But, I mean, what you just said, the three boards of the select boards from three towns can change this amongst themselves, correct?
Yep.
And each town has a vote.
Yep.
So it's all one third. So if Sunderland and Whately choose to change this language, we have no, it's just the way it goes.
I think that changes to the language have to be agreed upon by all three towns.
It has to be consensus.
Because
we don't sign.
And the board of oversight can't choose to change the agreement. Only the three select boards can choose to change the agreement.
It's an intermunicipal agreement, so we sign off on it.
Yep.
But if it's not an agreement with us, we don't sign.
Okay. So you, this is just the agreement the way it is, and you highlighted things just for our benefit that these might be some of the topics.
The items that were highlighted in this handout,
yep.
These are items that were the result of a thorough combing through this agreement by myself and by Zach Smith. Actually started with Zach, and then I looked at it, I added a few thoughts of my own. Some of it is cleaning up of language.
Like the fiscal agent, Deerfield voted to change the fiscal agent to a voting member. So we have three votes.
Okay.
But the other two towns haven't agreed to that yet.
Yeah,
right.
So that's one of the things we're going to discuss.
That's one of the things, right. Honestly, the term fiscal agent is used twice in this contract with different definitions. The town of Deerfield is the fiscal agent, but the town of Deerfield appoints a fiscal representative. Actually, not, we've been calling it a fiscal representative or a fiscal agent, but I'm trying to think of I'm looking for the exact term. Forgive me for Article 2 governance, Board of Oversight composition. The second sentence, it says, in addition, the fiscal agent, i.e. the town of Deerfield, shall appoint one designee to serve on the Board of Oversight as a non-voting member. That we want to change to a voting member, which would allow us as the fiscal agent to have a third vote on the Board of Oversight.
It still wouldn't make a difference, though.
It doesn't give Deerfield a majority, no. But at least with one vote from either of the other two towns, it would give Deerfield the ability to move things in a certain direction in contentious issues. Whereas right now, all it takes is three people from the other two towns and something doesn't pass. So.
Well, to tell you the truth, the way it's set up to operate is with consensus, and you don't, you know, you try to sort things out until you have consensus, and you're trying to have common ground and run it as a business as close as you can.
Mm-hmm.
So you don't really have content. I mean, there's usually only unanimous decisions.
That's been the understanding, is that even when there's been some disagreement initially, end vote is
we are changing. It was my idea to put the fiscal agent as a voting member so we get the third vote, but. In general, if we don't go along with something, then there's a real problem. And so hopefully people would work together to come to consensus, because the consensus is this is the best way to run things. And I mean, it's no different than us. We're not always going to agree, but what you try to do is you come to some consensus so that we all feel comfortable about moving forward. And I'm not looking for someone to just rubber stamp. I mean, that's worthless. We need to have discussion on everything, and you bring perspective, but you don't really move forward until you have some kind of consensus. And that's why, like I said on the OPEP, I just gave up. It wasn't worth arguing about, because I really didn't have a plan. I was spazzy because of the commitment. We have this liability that's overhead. And to me, more than $1 million seems like an awful lot, and we shouldn't be just kicking the can down the road. I mean, that's terrible. But we don't really know what our commitment is, and we don't have a plan. So, let it go for a while. And so that's the kind of consensus. We don't really necessarily agree, but we are still moving forward.
But I don't know how to word this. The service seems like it works well, and this is just my opinion. Is that the general consensus of the people involved in that are all like-minded, and so everything goes along pretty smoothly. But the problem comes in, where I see the problem, is always what it boils down to is money, and that this organization is pretty, and it's been doing a great job from what I hear, but it's also become a little bit wealthy in its own right, and you know,
well, that's not true.
I think, Kibbe, once you get into the math of it, mm-hmm. you'll find that hopefully in a few short years, I mean, everyone keeps saying it's never going to break even, but we're aiming towards a break-even service eventually. And if we get big enough and successful enough, that will happen. But our subsidy to it should be reducing every year, and even in the short period of time, it is costing us less to have a better service.
Does it function similar to a town where it's funded once or twice a year, and then money is put into their account, and they
it's an enterprise fund. So what happens is because it has a float, mm-hmm. it needs more of a float than a town because. We can go back if we have this $90,000 budget overrun for the insurance, say. Mm-hmm. We can go to the finance committee and we can get them to transfer their whole reserve fund to this amount, or we can have a special town meeting and we can appropriate money out of free cash if free cash has been certified, mm-hmm. or go to the stabilization fund or something. We have mm-hmm. options.
Okay.
But the enterprise fund can't come, and it's a one shot deal.
Right.
And so what you're trying to do is you have to have a float to cover, you don't know how many people are going to get sick. Okay, so that's the number one issue. How many runs are you going to have in a year? And mm-hmm. it's been very consistent, and it's growing. So we're around 1,000, which is, you know, what we anticipated. Or we anticipated 900, and that's why it made out a little bit more money this year. But then, not only do you have the runs, but then you also have the demographics of who has the insurance. Medicare and Medicaid do not pay very much. Okay,
right.
So you basically are running out, and you're hoping to pay for gas and staff. But demographically, we have a lot of private insurance in our area. So when that's billed out, that actually makes more money. So you win out of those 1,000 runs. Say there's 1,000 runs. How, you know, what's the percentage of private insurance versus Medicaid?
Well, the private insurance is about 43%. The non-insurance is 7%. Medicaid, Medicare is 50%, and they both split 50%. That's what Zach told me.
So anyway, yeah. You never know who's going to get sick, so you don't have the numbers are not correct always. But you're still paying for people to be on staff.
Right.
And then also you don't know what your insurance costs are going to be, you know, reimbursements. So you have to have a little bit of a float, more than a float, than just a budget. It's harder to budget. And then they were conservative in their startup because they weren't sure how much everything was going to cost. And so they spent less money. And so then it looked like they were carrying a lot of money. And they did reduce the assessments. And we're, every year is a better budgeting. This is Zach's second time for budgeting. And he was much better than he was the year before. And I think this year, because now they're full staff and they're up and running, and this will be Zach's third time around, I think it will be, a lot of these issues will go away.
To the same point, are you concerned at all that Zach in particular is at the highest pay level? That if he does a good job, that there's not necessarily room for him to get a raise because he's at the highest step allowable by our...
Well, what we're supposed to be looking, what's one of the things the personnel is looking at, our pay scales are supposed to be replaced every 7 years or adjusted every 7 years. And what has it been, 9 years, Doug?
Since 2000.
2009, I think. So it's been 7 years.
Okay.
Our pay scale should be adjusted every third year. With every seventh year, the entire class comp agreement should be reviewed.
Right.
But
and some things like...
We're working on that.
Clerical people, you know, what you're doing is what's the value of the job as compared to surrounding jobs. Some of those people are not going to change dramatically. Some other ones, their skill are going to go up because they... surrounding pay scales have gone up. So am I worried about that? Not necessarily, because we'll probably have to adjust it. And we would try to keep current with what is in the area. And if it doesn't go up, then he's at the top of the scale, and that's the way it is.
To that end, we are hoping to receive completed studies on the salary or the compensation charts, at least, from both the Collins Center as well as from Don Jacobs. We originally went to the Collins Center for Municipal Management to do a class comp study because the price was right and it sounded really great. To this point, I've received some results. I have not been satisfied with them whatsoever. I'm still trying to work with Mary Icardi to get a more formal response and report on the work that they've done. That being said, we are also contracting, or we've also contracted with Don Jacobs, who did our original class comp study 7 years ago. To do an apples-to-apples comparison. He's going back to the exact same towns that he used to compare. He's updated his formulas. He's updated his methodology. And I expect to meet with him a week from Friday and then to have a final report the first part of June.
We picked the towns that were similar to
in
us.
In size, geographics. In geographics. In EQV, equalized valuation, and in staffing, and in commercial, industrial, residential values. So hopefully it's an apples to apples comparison.
About
medium income.
Yes, all of that. It's strange, you know, in one case, one of the original towns back in 2009, I guess, that was suggested was Brimfield, which was struck from the list because it didn't make sense. It had a similar population, but nowhere near the same demographics, median household income, industrial base, or anything like that. The closest, some folks have said that Hadley is pretty close, but believe it or not, the closest two towns are Southampton and Orange. And they're both on the list. They're two of 12 or 13 towns.
Hadley should not be considered on. It's totally different. I mean, their commercial base is huge.
Yeah, the commercial base is huge.
Yeah.
Orange and Southampton are actually pretty close. There's another one I want to say. It's Central Mass. There's another town that's about the same population.
Is it Sterling? I can't remember.
Something like that, yeah.
But it just gives you an idea of what those people were paying and stuff like that.
Sure.
And,
yeah.
So we hope to have some solid answers very first part of June. And with that information, we need to go into negotiations with the police union.
The bigger picture, and I think this is really good, and I'm going to look at it. But, you know, it's, I guess sometimes my analogies might be a little bit strange, but it's kind of like if you have $100 there, then, well, you know, I really need $5 for my shoes. And, well, I really need $3 for milk. And, well, the kids need this, and the kids need that. Well, before the $100 is gone. And that, I think as leaders, it's unpopular, but we're going to have to start taking and making choices. And I don't necessarily want to point fingers at anyone, but you can't just always say, you know, rally the troops because we need these. You guys rally your troops because you get all these troops and they're all there, in a sense, special interests. They want what they want. And then the people, like the seniors, are the ones that are left out, you know. And in the long run, it really does hurt our community because a lot of the kids, you know, they get their education, they go off to school, and they go away because, you know, the Deerfield has these things that, you know, situations that just aren't so necessarily valuable to them. And the things that we're trying to protect in the long run, we're really kind of hurting, you know. And it's hard to, you know, say no or maybe cut this back or curve this or change that. But if we keep endorsing and saying yes to all these things, you know, our picture's just going to keep getting worse and worse and worse. And it's going to be very difficult to sit here and look at somebody over there and say, well, it's a good idea, but it's not right for us right now. And that's going to be very difficult thing to do.
But if we don't do it, this problem is going to just keep getting worse. You know?
Well, I mean, the library is a case in point. You know, it's supposed to be community use, and so we need to certainly invest with
I think it's going to be more of a community center than a library. I mean, in the big scheme of things, libraries are going the way of dinosaurs. You know, computers and things like that. I mean, you know, it's changed so much in the last 10 years. Just think what the next 10 years are going to be like. Pretty much anything that you're going to find over there, except for maybe some historic books for the town, you can get online. You know, the computer age is really changing everything. Even how, you know, I was reading this study about, you know, the biggest taxi company in the world is Uber, and they don't have one car, you know? So, you know, as cars are being able to drive around, you know, they're saying by, you know, 2050, most people aren't even going to have driver's license, because you're just going to go on your smartphone and the car is going to come here without a driver. You're going to get in the car, do what you want, and it's going to be computer controlled border. That's going to affect the insurance industry, because the insurance aren't going to have auto insurance policy. You know, it's got this whole ripple effect on how our world is changing.
It's changing fast.
And
the library will also be a community where everybody will go and use the computer.
It's a computer center. Exactly.
Computer center.
And I get that.
It will change. Yeah.
But, like, the point I was trying to make with all the glass to the north is, I mean, that's a simple thing to change, and you can save thousands of dollars.
Over the life of that.
I mean, you know, I don't have them here, but the amount of money that the town has spent heating that new elementary school is in the millions. You know, and it's not that big of a building. And it's just right from the get-go, it was never insulated. And, you know.
I just don't understand that.
Yeah, I know. But I can say, in the old building, I get up there in the 91 and I said, why are you guys even considering building a building without insulation? But what it was is that the folks that wanted the school so badly, they didn't want to hear anything but the schools going forward. And they didn't. And the people that were against it weren't against having the school, they were against the cost of it and the design of it, you know, and that's... I think it was a big community divider. It has lasted for a long time.
Mm-hmm. It did.
But anyways.
A couple of really, really quick notes. In the next couple of weeks, we're going to be completing an update of the town's website. We anticipate that the town's website will provide information to residents and businesses, folks looking to visit the town, and other folks interested in the town of Deerfield, faster, quicker, more efficiently.
Nice.
We are looking at tying that in a little bit more closely with the services provided by the PEG access provider, the video taped meetings, and so on and so forth. Kat Dolan has been very busy today alone working on posting agendas, minutes, and other documents in a public space that we've been paying for all along. We didn't even know it. Mm-hmm. General Code, the company that does our bylaws, also provides public document access. If we adopt this, if we really move forward with this, this will change the amount of work that we have to expend for Freedom of Information Act requests or public records requests, because they'll already be there. In just checking the site now, these documents, we put them up in whatever form we have, they get turned into a PDF that anybody can view and download, and it's entirely text searchable. So if you, I just did a search for South County EMS, SCEMS, and I found agendas, minutes, and other documents where South County EMS was even mentioned.
Great.
We are going to be working backward. We have at least 15 years worth of documents already in digital form. And as we continue forward this year, we're going to be scanning older and older documents. We'll also be applying in FY17 for a CPA grant to start digging into the archives, which are in the basement of this building. There are in the basement, in the vault, records of town meetings and select board meetings from the 1800s that we will be starting to scan and put online and make available to the public for viewing.
So I don't want to interrupt, but I have sometimes thoughts kind of just go through my head.
Sure.
Where my wife works in the old courthouse in Northampton, there's a group of UMass students, some class, where they go in for free of charge and they take documents and they archive them and put them on digital format for you. So, you know, I can find out, maybe you can reach out to them if you haven't already, and save the town a lot of
time effort, and they
yep.
do it.
Yep. Yep. That'd be terrific if there are people who are able to do that, who are, you know, budding archivists, and they want to start help us convert this over.
Maybe that's a project. I mean, it would probably be you have to supervise them, but...
Absolutely.
But it'd be great for you, master. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, they took a lot of the old documents from the old courthouse, and they did it real nice for me.
Yeah.
Nice. It'd be great.
So we talked about the website, we talked about this. We are... expecting folks in from King Information Systems. They're going to be doing a paper document inventory for us and provide us with some information about how we store our documents, the manner by which we store our documents, and they're going to help us organize what we have. That's going to be a 2 or 3 day process, and it's going to be both for the town clerk's office, the inspections office, and the administrator's office. Finally, we're going to be using some of the monies that are in the plumbing, gas, and wiring revolving fund to replace and upgrade hardware in the inspections office, also to provide them with scanning equipment as well. Mm-hmm. Priscilla has eliminated several file cabinets worth of duplicates, worth of redundant information, and so literally there's empty file cabinets there. Her next step is going to be a piece at a time to take a drawer, to take a file for a particular house, to scan all the documents that are in that, to turn that into a file that's then going into an archive, which we will then be able to search and make use of. We currently pay for a software called Laserfish, that will allow us to do that. We've got the infrastructure in place. We've got the storage in place. All we need are a few desktop scanners and a little bit of training, and we're on our way. So what we thought was going to take $55,000 worth of inventory and hardware, we're doing for a few hundred extra dollars and the purchase of some hardware. You have $500 scanners. So we're moving forward with
fantastic.
That.
Wow, that's fantastic. So you don't need that $55,000?
The $55,000 was going to be to provide us people to come in and digitally scan everything. I'm more interested in getting the money to provide archiving of the information that's in the basement here and the old town meeting reports that Barb has over in the vault, the more sensitive documents, because that's kind of like kid gloves handling the old books. They're very fragile. Right. But the current information, say the past 40 years, we're going to try to dig into that ourselves. So there's that.
So is that a yes, you want the $55,000, or no, you don't need the $55,000?
I would rather the $55,000. That request will probably be pared down, and it will probably be redirected to the CPC committee, specifically for the historic document preservation.
Well, why don't we get you that information about the UMass.
That would
they
also
can
be
do
helpful.
It for you.
Yep. There was a couple of things. We've got the final go-ahead for the renovation of the PEG access equipment. That's happening. That'll be happening in June. The local TV station is going to be upgrading their broadcast server. That's happening in June. And so that room is going to be ripped apart and then rebuilt, and we'll have better capability than we did before, and more reliable gear than we did before. I've been speaking with John Nove in regard to some things happening with the Historical Commission. They're moving forward with getting quotes for the storage case for the figure from the top of the Civil War Memorial.
Yep.
And the expectation is that sometime in the fall that will make a move. And it'll
speaking
be coming
of
down
which,
this way.
Thoughts just going through, you got those comments of the archaeological report from the Historic Commission to the DBU.
Yes. Oh, that was long ago. Yeah.
Thank you. I just forgot to check.
Yep. No, that happened a long time back, I think. We are moving forward with the sale of those three properties, the Coates Avenue property and then the two other lots up on Upper Road. We are going to have to do what's called a phase one site assessment for the Coates Avenue property. However, that's being paid for out of monies that were set aside in 2007 for redevelopment of the Oxford lot. $10,000 or so that was set aside then. The phase one assessment is being done by a company called Cold Spring Environmental, and it's about a $2,300 maximum price tag. A phase one environmental study will take a look at groundwater, it'll take a look at the history of the site, and it'll provide us with a document that basically says, no, you don't have to worry, there's no contamination here, or worst case scenario, yes, there could be contamination, we recommend going to phase two.
What happens if you just sell it?
We can't, or we won't sell it. The person who's the has been selected as the buyer, they want a phase one to be done. So
no one will buy anything unless
it's clean. Yeah.
What happened with that barn on the other side?
The barn on the other side of the Oxford property. The recommendation was to not award that to any bidder for a number of reasons. Not the least of which is the still undetermined nature of what's happening with the overall Oxford site. And I'll talk about that more off camera.
Okay.
If you want to talk about that.
Mm-hmm. Actually, we should go into executive session so we can approve the minutes.
Right. And then we'll come out afterwards only to adjourn?
Well, we need to sign the warrant.
So come out afterwards to sign the warrant and then to adjourn?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay.
So do you want to make a motion to adjourn regular meeting?
Sure. I make a motion to adjourn regularly.
To enter into executive session.
Enter into executive session.
For the purpose of reviewing and approving the executive session minutes. There you go.
The minutes of the executive session.
Now I pronounce you.
Yeah.
I'll second the motion.
Okay. Aye, Carolyn Ness.
Aye, Trevor McDaniel.
Aye, Henry Camosa.
Very good. Entering into executive session at 9:16 p.m. Coming out only to sign the warrant and then to adjourn.
Yes.
Very good. Thank you, okay. Everybody.
Yes.
Thank you very much.